Hey guys, welcome to The Gray Escape. I'm Natalie Gray, and this episode is 4 years in the making. I'll tell you all about it right after this. So by now, you guys have heard me speak many times about my mysterious experience in 2012, where, in a nutshell, I had a blood pressure crash that resulted in what is best described as a near-death experience, during which I went ice cold and began speaking scientific information. Yeah. Now, if you've listened to some of the previous episodes of The Gray Escape, like the ones with brilliant author Anthony Peake or sound healer Tony Neck, you'll have heard me speak about this. But for those who may be new to the show, the key message that I spoke about February 23rd, 2012, when this experience happened, was everything is an illusion. It is all our perception of an infinite range of frequencies and vibrations. And sound can heal everything. I had no science background, but I looked it up and I soon learned that, in fact, according to modern science and physics, everything is an illusion. There is no solid matter. You, me, your dog are indeed a range of frequencies and vibrations perceived by everyone else as, well, you, me, and your dog. The profound message that sound can heal everything left me on a path of research that continues to this day and takes me continually further afield. Focusing on the scientific support for my experience and Googling the words sound healing to oblivion, I soon stumbled upon sound scientist and cymatics pioneer John Stuart Reid, inventor of the Cymascope, a pretty sci-fi gadget that enables sound to become visible. But I was living in LA and John is in the UK, so I had to patiently wait till I was on the Cymascope side of the Atlantic. And the incredible day came recently when I, little old me with the crazy experience, was invited to the very lab in the UK where John conducts all of his research using his Cymascope. And I'm not the only one fascinated with this stuff. Esteemed author and researcher Rupert Sheldrake had also reached out to John and been granted a visit not too long before me, so I was in a very good morphic field. Heads up, in the past, I have split longer episodes into two parts, but this time I decided to post the entire interview all in one show. So get your ears ready. Strap on that awareness because there is some mind-blowing information heading straight to your brain. I'm not kidding. We go from dolphins to Nazis to the Da Vinci Code, even some 432 conspiracy thrown in for good measure. And of course, sound healing. We invited a couple of guests to listen in the lab, including John's lovely wife, Annalise. So you may hear a couple of asides directed at them. Okay. Here we go. From the Cymascope Lab in the beautiful Lake District, here's Cymascope creator and sound explorer, John Stuart Reid.
Now, I've been an acoustics engineer my whole career, but in recent years, I've become a scientist, you could say, in the sense that I am actually doing science. But my main career was in acoustics, and one of my areas of interest was, and always has been, Egyptology. And my daddy and I had been to Egypt many, many times. And on one particular occasion, we went to Cairo, and we went, of course, to see the Giza pyramids. And we had been before, but on this particular occasion, we were fortunate enough to be left alone in the king's chamber. And of course, my curiosity got the better of me, and I decided I would love to lie in the sarcophagus. You know, this 3.7-ton granite box, which is in the king's chamber. And I'd love to lie in that, I thought, and make some sound and see what resonances would occur. And so I did. And what occurred was really quite astonishing, because I did a glissando, you know, a kind of unstepped enunciation of a tone, like a ooh, this type of sound. And at one particular frequency, my whole body began to tingle, and I felt a kind of a wave of energy, acoustic energy, obviously washing over me. And I thought, well, this is obviously not normal. You don't get this kind of effect in everyday life. And it occurred to me in that moment that this perhaps was designed. It may have been an actual design feature of the pyramid and of the king's chamber. And so that thought led ultimately to me going back to Egypt a few months later, after gaining permissions, to do some acoustics experiments in the King's Chamber. And I actually went back twice. I went in 1996, and then because I couldn't complete all of the experiments in the first mission, I went back again in 1997. And it was the 97 experiments that were really... Well, they were groundbreaking, that's for sure, but also something extremely significant happened in terms of a healing for me. So just to backtrack a little bit, about 3 weeks before I went out to do these 1997 experiments, I injured my lower back quite severely. I mean, I've had a number of injuries, you know, I'm a tall, slim guy, lift something the wrong way or whatever. And in this particular instance, I had really severe back pain, so much so that I didn't know whether I was going to be able to actually go to Egypt. You know, I thought I was going to perhaps have to cancel the whole thing. But anyway, I did in the end manage to go. I took a lot of painkillers and had other people to help carry in all of the equipment and so on. And I was in a lot of pain. But I got into the King's Chamber. And the only other person that was there, that was allowed to be there, apparently, was the antiquities inspector. So he stood around, you know, waiting for me to set up. He helped a little bit. And I was still in this, you know, painful, very, very painful state. Well, this particular experiment was designed, this was the one that I couldn't complete in 96, was designed to see if I could make the resonances of the sarcophagus visible.
Wow.
And so the way that I conceived to do that, I'd heard about the work of Hans Jenny, who was this Swiss artist and medical doctor who had worked with what he termed, he coined this word cymatics, which is basically the study of visible sound. Cymatics spelled C-Y-M-A. Anyway, he had, you know, done a lot of really great work in the 1960s in visible sound. In cymatics. And so I conceived of this idea where I would stretch a membrane across the open top of the sarcophagus and level it all off, you know, make it as level as I possibly could. I would put a loudspeaker in the bottom of the sarcophagus and then sprinkle sand on the membrane, a bit like sprinkling chocolate on a chocolate cake, you know, and then switch on the oscillator, this medium of this electronic oscillator to make sound into the speaker, and then see what happened. See, you know, if there were any particular dominant resonances in the sarcophagus. I knew that there had been a dominant resonance around 100 hertz. That was the one that obviously gave me all those tingles, you know, a couple of years earlier. So I was interested to see that one and just to see if there were any other, you know, powerful resonances. But what happened was really quite astonishing, because only about 20 minutes into the experiment, we were getting all sorts of fantastic images on the sarcophagus. And I'm not talking about just random patterns. We were getting what looked like hieroglyphs.
Wow.
Ancient Egyptian hieroglyphs were popping out on the membrane.
Wow.
And the antiquities inspector, who had been extremely bored up to this point, thinking, I think we've got a slightly mad Englishman here, but he didn't seem to mind, because obviously we'd paid a lot of money to do this work. Anyway, he now came rushing across to look at the sarcophagus and see these amazing patterns. He said, how can I help you? What can I do? You know, he was obviously very excited, as I was. And only a few minutes later, I realized that all of the pain in my back had gone, had left me completely. And I thought in the moment, well, this has to be just endorphins. I'm obviously very happy. I'm very excited at seeing these, what looked like ancient Egyptian hieroglyphs. And so that was the thought that went through my mind, that I'm basically full of endorphins, and that when I get back to the hotel in a few hours' time, and that wears off, the pain will come back with a vengeance. But the truth is that the pain never, ever came back. Wow. So much so, I was actually able to help pack up the equipment, and the guys who came back into the King's Chamber, you know, to help carry it, well, they did carry some of it, but I carried some of it as well. In other words, my back had been healed, wow. Or at least that's what I believed at the time. And then we got outside the pyramid, we went back to the hotel, and I was still thinking, this pain is going to come back soon. But it never, ever did. You know, I was able to go back to the airport, carry the cases myself, get back on the aircraft, and it never, ever came back. So I realized there had been a genuine healing of my lower back. Hmm. The question was, of course, what was the mechanism? How had that sound, or some of the sounds I'd been making in the pyramid, how had they caused this this healing? And that's been a journey that I've been on ever since. But the other thing, this other significant aspect to this, was that I realized that creating, making sound visible in this way had the essence of a new scientific tool. You know, if you can make something visible, our visual acuity is so powerful in comparison with our other senses that we can understand a lot more about any aspect of science with our vision than we can with our, you know, auditory sense or touch sense or any other sense. And so I realized that this had the makings of a very powerful new tool for science. If only we could tame it, if we could capture it in a form that where we could reproduce the same pattern with the same sonic input each time and make sound visible, in which case I reasoned at the time, if we could do this, it could open new doors in all sorts of different areas of science. And that's the journey that I started in 1996 and 1997, and I've been on ever since.
And so just to be clear, when you stretch the membrane over the sarcophagus, I mean, I've watched hordes of YouTube videos on cymatics, which for listeners, you can Google them easily on YouTube, but normally you'll see a surface with some sand, a note or resonance will be played, and a very symmetrical shape will form. So you're saying that rather than it being a symmetrical shape, some flower pattern or star pattern, you almost saw these hieroglyph letters that weren't in some sort of symmetry. They were individual shapes.
That's absolutely right. They were individual shapes. And that was what was so astonishing, because just as you said, you know, normally you would expect what a termed standing wave patterns, you would get a symmetrical pattern on a membrane. That is quite typical.
Wow.
But these were definitely atypical. And it was astonishing to see what looked like hieroglyphs. And of course, you know, a lot of people subsequently, when I began to publish them, I published them in an article called Egyptian Sonics. And a lot of people, when they saw them, wanted to understand how it is that you could possibly have hieroglyphs embedded in granite within a sarcophagus that the Egyptians had made. A lot of people obviously believe, or do believe, that the Egyptians had high technology, and that maybe, you know, they'd somehow very cleverly embedded these hieroglyphs. Well, I don't actually have that same belief myself. I don't think they did have very high technologies. They certainly had some technologies, and they had technologies even that we are not using today. But the answer to the question, I think, is much simpler than some people might imagine. It's simply that all sounds have structure and form when these sounds encounter a membrane. So any sound has a structure when it encounters a membrane. And in the case of these various patterns that look like hieroglyphs, if you go back in history to a point in time that's in the area of 3900 BCE, then you come to a place in Egypt called Hierakonpolis, also called ancient Nekhen. And in this little town that I have been to, it's the place where hieroglyphs were first began to be developed. But it's also in the same town and the same date in history, around the same date in history, when the Egyptians first started to work granite and other hard stones. You know, before this, they'd been working limestone and been working a lot in wood, for example. So some of the early temples were fashioned from wood. But then around that time, they started to fashion temples in stone, and they started to fashion lintels and other column bases and so on in granite, in these very hard stones that they would bring up from Aswan, which was the major source of granite in Egypt. So when you work with granite, one of the things that becomes very clear when you start striking granite in order to shape it in some way, you know, you have to, if you want to create an object of beauty or functionality, you've got to shape your natural piece of granite into some object. In this case, let's say it's a sarcophagus. Well, when you start striking the granite, it rings like a low-pitched bell. But also, if you hear that sound, if you listen very carefully to that sound, or if you look at it, look at the output on an analyzer, acoustic analyzer, you'll see that it's not just a simple sound. It's actually a rich sound. It's, in other words, it's got harmonic content. And so these rich sounds, when you have a membrane in the vicinity, would naturally form a beautiful pattern of some form on the membrane. Now, how we get from that point to hieroglyphs in a sarcophagus is an interesting one. And, you know, there's various directions you could take with that. One might be, for example, for argument's sake, that there was a drumhead lying nearby in the quarry, you know, where the guys are working. And it's possible that patterns were occurring naturally on the drumhead from these very loud sounds that they would be making in the quarry where they were, you know, working the sarcophagus into shape. And that possibly those patterns that appeared on the drumhead were inspiration for the scribes who were standing around, you know, making a note of the work that was being done, because in those days, the workmen were paid on the amount of work that they did. Literally, they were timed by scribes who would, you know, or supervisors who would stand around and watch other people work and take a note. And then the men would be paid in grain or beer or whatever it was. So there would be scribes in the vicinity, and it would be those same scribes who ultimately were responsible for developing the hieroglyphic language. So there's one hypothesis. It may not be and I have other ideas that, you know, that are more complex than that, but that's a nice simple way to visualize how you get from this position of hieroglyphic language being developed in 3900 BC, thereabouts, and then how virtually 5,000 years later, you know, John Stuart Reid goes into the pyramid and sees hieroglyphs coming out of the sarcophagus.
So you're saying that basically they could have potentially taken those hieroglyphs from shapes they were seeing on their drums.
Well, inspired.
Inspired.
A loud sound is created when you strike the granite, and then that loud sound creates a pattern on a drum head, and the scribe sees this pattern forming. I mean, it would be, Even today, you know, earlier I showed you patterns on a Chladni plate. When you see a sound pattern form right in front of your eyes, it is quite a significant moment, isn't it? You know, when you
it's
see
pretty
sand,
mind-blowing.
It is. You see sand dancing on a plate or a membrane. In this case, we're talking about a drum head. When you see a pattern form right in front of your eyes, when you hear a sound, and that sound causes vibration of the membrane, and the little sand grains all sort of jump into position, they all want to apparently be in a particular position, and then this beautiful pattern emerges, well, it's quite significant. And I can well imagine that the scribes would have been very impressed by what they saw, and maybe they thought it was magic. I don't know. But if they did see something like that, you can easily imagine that they would have been inspired to use some of these patterns in their hieroglyphs. And so some of the patterns, you know, to give you an idea of what they look like, one was a row of striations that very strongly resembled the backbone of the god Osiris. You know, this sort of multi-layered striations that looked like a spinal column for all the world. It wasn't static on the membrane. It was sort of snaking. It had a dynamic aspect to it. And this was the one that the antiquities inspector got so excited about. You can imagine, you're seeing this snaking jet pillar, you know, on a membrane on the sarcophagus. It was quite a moment. Anyway, so that's one of them. There was also Ra, the sun god hieroglyph, which is a concentric circle. So you have a circle with a circle inside it. That was very, very strong and clear on the sarcophagus. Mm. Also, the symbol for protection, the Sar loop, as it's called, which is a kind of crossed loop. That was, again, very solid and clear on the sarcophagus. And there were so many of them that, you know, you can't just dismiss it all as being happenstance. There has to be a valuable mechanism, a valuable lesson to learn from all of this.
Did you ever take your hieroglyphs to be decoded by any sort of expert?
Yes, a number of Egyptologists looked at them and said, oh, yes, that's interesting, isn't it? You know, but you see, I just think that these kind of ideas, these concepts are so unusual, let's say, and so out of the realm of normal mainstream science, mainstream Egyptology, that they're probably a little bit too far ahead of their time in some respects to be taken seriously. But there is clearly a mechanism that needs to be investigated.
I mean, I think, what if those sound frequencies over a sarcophagus, where clearly a lot of effort has gone into making it because it's out of granite, which can't have been, I wouldn't think, easy to work with. What if that was their equivalent of our modern day gravestones? And what if those hieroglyphs are messages just going, here lies, you know, Ra-Vul, he had a good life. He leaves behind two daughters and a dog.
That's an interesting, it's a very interesting thought, Natalie. But the problem, I think, with that is then we start having to think about, oh, well, the ancient Egyptians must have had some form of high technology.
And, John, are you shooting down my scientific theory?
I know I am.
But right out of the gate.
I'm so sorry about that, Natalie. But, you know, obviously we all have our beliefs. And in this case, my beliefs in terms of the ancient Egyptians comes from having had more than 20 visits to ancient Egypt, to Egypt, rather, and studying, you know, the stone structures, you know, making observations about their technology. And so, over those many years that I've been to Egypt, I've gained this impression that the ancient Egyptians did not have high technology. They certainly had technologies. And they had, like I said earlier, they had technologies that we're not even using today because we don't need them. You know, we have other technologies in our modern lives. But certainly they were very clever and accomplished people. But I still say I don't believe they had high technologies, and you would need high technologies to deliberately embed sonic messages, if you like, into the granite.
Well, how do you think those hieroglyphic resonances got there then, if they didn't have fancy technology?
Well, maybe I missed that part of my hypothesis out. It's just the fact that granite contains natural resonances. So if you strike granite with a hard instrument, or in the case of the experiments that I was doing, if you excite it acoustically, sonically, then you will bring out the natural resonances in the granite. And as I said earlier, every sound, if a sound that you're creating encounters a membrane, it will create a pattern on that membrane. Even though the pattern is invisible, you know, in our normal lives, it's nevertheless there. The pattern is there. And if you have the correct technology, you can make that pattern visible. Mm. So in this case, with the sarcophagus, those guys in the quarry that were, you know, that were striking it, they would have been encountering those sonic patterns, whether they found them through the method that I suggested with a drum head, or whether there was some other way, perhaps subliminally, because, you know, we're going to talk later about cellular patterning and how every cell in our body literally receives a pattern of sound when we make sound. I don't know. You know, obviously, there is definitely a mystery here to be solved. But it's very, very worthwhile and exciting mystery to look into.
I mean, the part that I'm suspicious about, having seen so many of the cymatics imagery, is the fact that it wasn't a symmetrical sort of a shape. It sounds like it was writing. you know, with these hieroglyphs. I mean, that just doesn't sound like something that you would expect to see from a vibration. You'd accept a pattern, and it sounds like it wasn't a pattern. It was individual shapes, unless you've just been leading me astray.
No. These were definitely what looked like ancient Egyptian hieroglyphs, no question about that.
See, I'm not shooting down your theory.
Okay, very good, very supportive. There is a lot more to this, a lot more depth, and it really would require a discussion about the holographic aspects of sound. Ooh. Because all sounds have holographic aspects to them.
And now you're talking.
And it's the holographic aspect of sound that allows us to create patterns or forms on the surface and subsurface of water that are not necessarily what you would think of as a normal symmetrical standing wave pattern. In other words, images rather than patterns or symmetrical patterns. And it's the holographic aspect of sound that allows that to happen. And so there are other aspects to my work. For example, the dolphin work that we've been doing, where we are imaging the sounds of dolphins, the echolocation sounds of dolphins, and seeing the actual reflections creating patterns on the surface of water that are the objects themselves, but, you know, shapes, the actual shapes of the objects on the surface of water. So again, not standing wave patterns as such, but actual images of objects.
Yeah, I have in my hand, and with your permission, I'll put a photo on the website. I've got a actual 3D, what looks like a coaster with a bit like a moon man on it, but that's actually a man that was underwater, and this was formed with your fancy gear and the help of a dolphin who was recognizing this man with his echo, what do you call it? Echo sonar?
Echolocation.
Echolocation. And you took a lot of flack for this, right? People not believing that this was the dolphin's
Absolutely.
Work.
Yes. Well, this work...
Can I just say I know how it feels now that my whole gravestone thing has just been popped before it even got off the ground. So I know how you felt there.
Oh, thank you. This is work in collaboration with Jack Kasowitz and his company, speakdolphin.com. And Jack and I have been collaborating many years now. The initial collaboration started in 2010. And in 2011, we had our real first success story because Jack had this wonderful idea to task a dolphin to echolocate on a series of objects, plastic objects that he put into a pool, a dolphin research pool. And so the dolphin would come up to, say, a flower pot or a plastic cross that Jack had made, or a cube, a plastic cube, or a ball, or so on. It was a series of eight objects that were put into the water, submersed in the water, held under the water, actually, by Jack or one of his assistants. And then the dolphin would come up to the object and echolocate, you know, send its sonar beam out to the object. And then Jack would arrange a hydrophone. This is like an underwater microphone in the vicinity, you know, to basically record the reflected or to monitor the reflected sound from the object. And he had this idea thinking that perhaps the sound that was reflected from the object would in some way represent the object, which it's an interesting idea that he had. And it turned out that to be absolutely spot on, because what happened was, well, the first step was that the dolphin... echolocated on each of these eight objects in turn. The recordings were then played back to the dolphin via an underwater speaker. And Jack was basically tasking the dolphin to identify the object from the sound alone. So let's say he has these eight objects in the water and he plays the sound of a plastic duck. That was one of the objects in the water.
Very scientific.
So yes. And so does the dolphin go to the flower pot? No, the dolphin goes to the plastic duck just by listening to the sound alone. And Jack repeated this experiment many, many times. And he came up with a statistic of 86% accuracy that the dolphin identified the correct object, you know, from listening to the sound alone. Oh. Then he had this absolutely amazing idea that I wouldn't have had for sure. He took those sound recordings to a different dolphin facility, put the same eight objects in the water with a different dolphin who'd clearly never heard these sounds before, never seen these objects before, and repeated the whole experiment. And this new dolphin could identify the object with a similar high success rate as the other dolphin. Mm. So therefore, firm evidence that the sound itself was the means by which the dolphin could identify the shape of the object. So then the next thing that Jack did was, he obviously got very excited about this. That was a breakthrough in itself. I mean, that's something that had never been done before. The next thing he did was he got on the phone to me, excited, obviously, and shared his news. And he said, "Do you think, John, that if you were to put these sounds into your Cymascope instrument, that we would get some kind of an unusual image out of it?" Well, I was actually a little bit doubtful, to be honest, because I didn't really believe at that time that we would see anything. I didn't think we would anyway. But I tried to stay open, of course, and I was willing to do the experiment. So Jack sent the sound files through on email. And one by one, you know, I put them into the Cymascope. And it was a very tricky procedure. The reason it was tricky is because with a normal standing wave pattern, it occurs usually after a second or two. You need a little bit of time for the energy to enter the water and to stabilize into a pattern, into a standing wave pattern. But these sounds were very short-lived. I mean, they were little clicks, if you know what dolphin sounds are like, a kind of series of sharp little clicks.
Yeah.
And so it was extremely tricky to do. In order to get a result, any kind of result at all, there had to be extremely high levels of acoustic energy, so much so that you wouldn't want to be in the lab while this work was going on. You wouldn't have wanted to be there.
Huh.
I had to wear, obviously, ear protectors. Very, very high sound pressure levels, you know, way over 105 dBs.
Wow. And
then the other problem, the other little challenge, was synchronizing the camera with the resulting imprint on the water. That synchronization was a significant challenge. But eventually, there was the shape of a flower pot in the water. It was astonishing. It was an astonishing moment to see literally a picture of a flower pot in the water.
Wow.
It was faint. I had to enhance it a little bit in Photoshop just to enhance the contrast. But once you'd enhanced the contrast, it was very clearly a flower pot. Not only was there a flower pot, but there was also the hand of whoever it was, whomever had actually been holding the flower pot in the water. There was the hand holding the flower pot.
Yeah.
Which was also interesting.
This is very James Bond.
Oh, yes. And then I went on to image a whole series of other objects, including the cross, this plastic cross that Jack had put into the water. And the interesting thing about the cross was that it wasn't on axis. You know, it wasn't like a cross right in the center of the water. It was off towards one side of the water, you know, the water and the Cymascope device. So it was kind of off axis, you could call it. And we figured out in the end that the reason for this is because the dolphin, when a dolphin approaches an object, it moves its head a little bit, its rostrum, in order to scan the object with its sound beam. So it's not keeping absolutely stationary.
It's doing a scan.
It's doing a kind of scan. And obviously at the very moment that Jack captured this sonic image with the hydrophone and all his high-end audio equipment, the dolphin must have been looking off towards one side, a little bit one side of the cross.
Hmm.
Anyway, we got the image of the cross.
He was kind of taking on a skeptical look.
I don't think so. But anyway, we got the cross and we got several other objects. The one that was a definite challenge was the plastic duck, because this duck had no head. Okay, it was just like an oval.
That's just unfair to the dolphin.
I know. So it was just an oval shape, basically. And I thought, well, it looks a little bit like the bottom of a duck, but where's the head? So I called Jack up this day and I said, Jack, I'm really struggling with this plastic duck image. There's no head. And I said, you know, have you got any idea why that might be? And he laughed out loud on the phone. And he said, I'll not attempt to do his American accent, but he's a really great guy and he's got a lovely accent. Anyway, he said essentially that the reason that the duck had no head was because he had been holding the duck by the head under the water. Mm. So the only part of the duck that right. the dolphin could see was literally the bottom of
right,
the duck.
Right, okay.
And so that's why it had no okay. head. Anyway, so that was the success from 2011. And then fast forward to, you know, just a few months ago, Jack had this other brilliant idea of immersing a whole man in the water. And this guy is called Jim, and he was willing to go under the water and hold his breath so that, you know, he didn't create any bubbles or anything that might disturb the image.
This very famous man called Jim.
Jim. And Jim is the first man in history, you know, to offer himself to a dolphin in this way. And so Jack tasked the dolphin to echolocate on Jim and had the hydrophone off to one side, which was an interesting position for it, but nevertheless he caught this reflection from Jim, from the, you know, the echolocation beam strikes Jim, reflects off, is captured at the side by the hydrophone. The signal goes off to some very high-end audio processing gear, and then ultimately I get the, you know, the email attachment, which is this sound. So again, I was, you know, even despite the 2011 success, I was kind of skeptical, wasn't really, you know, that hopeful that we would get a result from such a large object. But Annalise was with me in the lab this day when she came down and I said, look at this image, Annalise, you know, what does this look like? And she said, it looks like a man. I said, yes, it does look like a man. But, oh, I'm missing part of the story out here. I'm so sorry. Because what Jack had told me he was sending me was a face. He wanted to capture the image of a face. He didn't actually tell me about the man. Yes, I'm remembering the story now. He said he wanted to capture a face. And so I put this sound file into the Cymascope and saw this picture of what looked like a man, a full man. And Annalise came in the lab and I showed Annalise and I said, you know, what do you think that looks like? She said, it looks like a man. I said, I know, but Jack told me he was sending me the image of a face. Anyway, it turned out that Jack had kind of did a blind experiment on me.
Oh, to test you.
To test, well, to test
smart,
the whole...
So that you couldn't
smart.
Manufacture what you no, thought were going to be the results.
I was completely blind. I had no idea that he'd actually used a full man.
Smart. I mean, I would want to trick you too.
Oh, would you?
You seem so shifty. I would...
Oh, that's interesting. Anyway... So there was the full man, and it was astonishing. And then a few days later, Jack had analysed this the video, because I'd taken a video of this man, image of a man. And Jack analysed it frame by frame and called me up one day and said, you need to look at, you know, frame so-and-so before the image of the man occurs. And what you will see is that another image of the man, but his hand is in a different position, right? So first he has his hand down here, you know, lower down by his waist.
Mm.
And then in the next frame, his hand is higher, you see? And so in other words, what we were seeing was effectively, in a sense, like two frames of a movie.
Like time.
Yeah, I mean, you know, if we had a whole series of, say, 24 frames and we could run them in a second, you would see a whole movie of Jim moving his hand from point A to point B. And so that was an exciting moment as well. And then Jack had this great idea to make this man, this Jim, the image of Jim, visible in a 3D print. You know how 3D printers these days are all the rage and people are printing all sorts of things in three dimensions now in plastic and in other materials. Anyway, he sent this image off to an imaging company that work in 3D and created these wonderful, well, in this case, the object that you've got in your hand there, just a little coaster But he's also created much larger versions of the image of the man. And we call this coaster the Little Man.
Okay.
And
no offense, Jim.
No offense.
You know.
But yeah, it's a wonderful image of Jim just holding his hand up and sort of saying hello to the dolphin. And we're very proud of that image.
So I know you didn't buy into my whole gravestone from the 3000 BC or whatever, but how's this for a plan then, from what you just said? Would it be feasible that you could take a little supersensitive sound recorder and you could place it in a room and leave it there as like a security monitor? And let's say you got robbed, you would take the box and you'd play the recording back through your gadget and get a visual playback of what happened in that room.
Gosh.
Could that actually happen? Am I onto something?
You might be. That's a very interesting idea.
I mean, why not? What, if you can do it with a dolphin and his sound, why can't you just have it with the sounds of the room and play back time as it happened?
Well, you could. I mean, as I mentioned earlier, sound has holographic properties. And that's the principle behind what we're doing here with the Cymascope and being able to image what the dolphin saw, or something like what the dolphin saw, perhaps. It's the holographic principles. And it brings to mind, actually, a story relating to what some people thought were ghosts in relation to a pub in Wales. And it's very relevant to that, in the sense that in this particular pub in Wales, there's a room upstairs where voices had been heard from the room. And this gentleman that called me, he's called John Mark, he's no longer with us, sadly, but at the time he was willing to talk to me about his experiences in relation to this room, because I'd heard on the grapevine that John had made a recording of these sounds in this room. And so I got in my car, went down to Wales and had a lovely long chat with John. And what he told me was that he'd sat outside the room. He had a reel-to-reel, you know, one of those old kind of Revox tape recorders. He put it in the room, and he sat outside this door of the room and just sat there all night waiting for this tape recording to happen. He heard some strange sounds through the door. He didn't know what they were. In the morning, he took up his Revox, went home, and played the sounds back. And what he found was that they were very, very low-pitched sounds, not understandable. It sounded like voices, he said, but very low-pitched. And so he speeded them up, and it turned out that it was a conversation, or more likely an argument, between two men.
Whoa.
And it turned out that one of these men, in the history, actually murdered the other.
Oh.
They had a fight, they had an argument. One murdered the other. This is a local story,
wow,
in Wales. Anyway, the upshot of all that was that John mentioned the story, mentioned this, what had happened, to a local radio station, and they put it out, in Wales. And the story got picked up by the various networks. It even ended up in the USA. And a few weeks later, two men in black with, dark glasses came to his door. And it turned out they were from the CIA.
Oh, my goodness.
And they said, hi, John, can we borrow your tape? And
Whoa.
He agreed, and he actually gave them the tape, and he never saw it again.
Oh, my goodness.
But anyway, the reason I'm mentioning all of that in very, very brief detail is simply because it does kind of, it's reminiscent of what you've just said, isn't it?
It just makes sense to me. I mean, that seems to be, I would hazard a guess, that would be the future of our security systems, would be sonic, and that you could replay time just by the sounds echolocating off your environment.
Absolutely.
Why not? I'll give you 50%. We'll call it your future is sound. Come on. Come on.
Uh-huh. Well, you could be right. You know, certainly because of the holographic aspect of sound that we've been able to demonstrate very clearly with the Cymascope, it does mean that any sound, and if we'd had those sound files, from John Mark's experiments all those years ago and put those into the Cymascope, wouldn't that have been interesting to see what we could have seen from those sound files?
Why would the CIA take from a pub in Wales? What on earth would
they? Well, the whole concept behind that, of course, is the thing that's so interesting to me, because, and this is why I jumped in the car and went to you know, have my conversation with John is because how can a wall in a pub in Wales store acoustic information? That's the question. You know, there's this old saying, you might have heard it, walls have ears.
Right.
And there are various articles that I've read on this type of subject. One, for example, where there was a painting where a scientist was able to extract a word from the painting simply because as the artist was painting a very thin line in the painting, say a hair, you know, on someone's head. I can't remember now what it was, but it would have been something like that, where the artist was using a single mohair to paint literally a hair on someone's head, for example. Mm-hmm. Well, as he's doing so, if he talks or speaks, he's probably not, he's probably holding his breath. But let's say someone comes in the room and maybe it's his wife and she's angry that he's not spending enough time with her or something. And she shouts. Well, that sound would wobble his hand slightly, wouldn't it?
Like a sort of making a vinyl record where
exactly.
You've got the little crevices of
And
movement.
So this scientist was able to scan that little wobble in the hair and and capture the sound that was created in that moment. It also brings to mind the granite core that I came across in the Petrie Museum in London. There's this lovely little museum called the Petrie Museum that was started by Flinders Petrie. And in this museum, there is a granite core. I think its number is UC16306 or was it 160? Anyway, it's this granite core is basically what the Egyptians would have thrown away from having drilled a hole into a piece of granite. So they were wanting to, say they wanted to create a hinge for a door.
Right.
And you have a sill of the door that is made of granite and you want to create a hinge post. So you drill a hole in the granite with a tubular drill. And the result of that tubular drill hole is that you have a core of granite and you just put a chisel into the groove, you crack it out and you throw it away onto a dump heap. And that's exactly where Flinders Petrie found it.
I love that you don't think that they had super technology.
Well,
but that they're drilling through granite with a drill.
Do you call that high technology?
I think for back then that seems pretty high technology to have a drill that will go through granite.
It's certainly technology. I wouldn't define it as high technology. But anyway, so to come back to the story. So this Flinders Petrie found this granite core and put it as an object in his museum. And then obviously I was a visitor to the Petrie Museum, saw the granite core. I had taken a really good camera and various lighting equipment and so on to take, with permission, you know, take photographs of this granite core because I was very interested. I've always been interested in the ancient Egyptians' working of hard stone. How did they work hard stone? You know, in the Old Kingdom, when they were working granite, for example, from the Egyptological model, they only had copper tools. Well, copper will not cut granite. Not carve. You can't carve granite with copper tools. You can cut it with a tubular drill if you've got a cutting agent like sand, for example. You can cut through it slowly, but you can't sculpt it, let's say. So anyway, I've always been interested in this subject of how did the ancient Egyptians sculpt, you know, work their hard stones into beautiful statues and things at a time when they're supposed to not have iron. You know, they only had copper, allegedly. Anyway, so that's why I was interested in this tubular drill, because it came from an Old Kingdom dump heap. So it was cut, you know, at a time when they didn't have iron tools. They only had copper. Anyway, so I was taking these photographs. And a few months later, they ended up being published in a friend's book. And this book is called Giza, the Truth. And it was Ian Lawton and Chris Ogilvy Herald who published this book. And this picture of the granite core ended up in the book. And then a few more weeks went by after the book was published. And I got this call from a gentleman who, I don't know who he'd got my telephone number from. But anyway, he called me and he said, I've just been looking at your photograph in the book Giza, the Truth, of this granite core. And I said, oh, yes. And he said, it looks like an Edison phonograph cylinder. And I said, well, actually, you're right. It does, because it's kind of, it's about 5 inches long. It's tapered, slightly tapered from one end to the other. In other words, one end's a slightly fatter diameter than the other end. Not only that, it has wiggly grooves all the way around it, very like an Edison phonograph cylinder. And I said, of course, that is entirely coincidental. You know, that you're not suggesting that the ancient Egyptians had phonographs, are you? And he said, oh, no, of course not. He said, but won't those wiggly grooves contain acoustic information?
Yeah.
Oh, I said, now that's starting to sound interesting. And of course, that is true, that those, or it could be true, that those wiggly grooves, how did those wiggly grooves get onto the outside of that core? And, you know, when you think about it, they would have had, in order to drill into a very thick piece of granite, you know, say the sill or the lintel of a door to create a hinge, you would have to drill a hole, let's say for argument's sake, 2 inches diameter, which is about what this piece is. It would take a significant amount of time for that tubular, that copper tubular drill to work its way through the granite. And what happens, it's interesting, when you're drilling into granite with a tubular drill, even today, we're using different methods, different materials, I should say. We're not using copper anymore. You know, we use diamond-sintered tubular drills today. But the same problem occurs, and what happens is that as you're drilling into a piece of granite or other hard stone, there's a buildup of dust naturally, you know, from the material. As the material is being worn down, there's a buildup of dust. And what you have to do is extract the tubular drill and wash out the dust in order that the dust doesn't prevent further cutting. You see, this is what you do, even today. And so you can imagine the ancient Egyptians, perhaps they had a capstan with ropes around it and they had beasts of burden, you know, turning the capstan to turn this tubular drill, perhaps. Or it may even have just been, you know, two guys with a bow saw, a bow drill. But however they did it, they would have had to keep stopping to extract the tubular drill. And in those moments when you're extracting the drill, if the drill is still turning while you're extracting it, then you would get wiggly grooves on the sides of the granite core. And that's exactly what this granite core has, these wiggly grooves. And they may well contain acoustic information.
Has nobody tried?
No, as a matter of fact, I've spoken with the Petrie Museum about this, and they're actually willing for work to be done on it, you know, under supervision, obviously. And so perhaps one day, you know, that work will be done where you wouldn't literally need to play it back like a phonograph cylinder. What you would do is you would scan it with a laser metrology system where it's only light, basically, that's bouncing off these wiggly grooves. And then you would see if they contain any audio data. It might be two Egyptians shouting at each other, you know, in the background.
Or they could be as good as the Beatles.
Who knows? Well, they might have been singing while they worked, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Or they might have been, you know, might have been the supervisor shouting at want this guy to do his work better or faster, or who knows? I mean, wouldn't that be something if we actually got a conversation of an Egyptian or even the song of an Egyptian worker?
I wonder if, you know, the way you said they've got a word off a painting because of a single hair done with the hair of a brush. I mean, wouldn't it be interesting to take a painting like the Mona Lisa or something and see if some resonance came off that? You know, some guy going, would you keep still? Seriously, stop blinking, you know.
Uh-huh. Well, it would be interesting. It's an interesting principle, this whole business of how very finely painted line can contain audio data.
Yeah.
Or in the case of the granite core, how that might contain audio data. It's an interesting principle and one that perhaps in the future we'll be spending some time on.
Well, I bet in the future, because there's so much more burgeoning interest in sound and in frequencies and vibrations. I'm sure it'll be used in forensics in the future. They'll probably be able to capture resonance signatures off people's belt buckles and stuff to capture criminals.
Maybe.
Or am I just really having an overactive imagination?
Well, it's fun to think about these things, that's for sure.
Mm-hmm. you had said about when you gave me a little demonstration of the sand on the plate, how you believe sound, of course, played a big role in the primordial soup and the, you know, the formation of matter.
Yes, sound in the early universe, it's one of the mainstream cosmological models. So you know that if you look up in the sky with a powerful telescope, you will see groups of galaxies. You know, there might be a group of galaxies in one sector of the sky, and then, you know, turn the telescope, I nearly said cymoscope, turn the telescope a few degrees, and then you might see another group of galaxies. So why is it that galaxies are clustered in different areas of the sky? Wouldn't you expect gravity to cause a kind of general even distribution of galaxies across the sky? Why are they grouped in this way? Well, one of the mainstream models that suggests why they are grouped in this way was because of sound in the early universe. So, you know, the mainstream model of the how the universe began was with the Big Bang. And with any Big Bang or any kind of event of that nature, there would be obviously a significant pressure of sound. Whenever you have matter bumping against matter, you have, you know, what is defined as sound. And the mainstream model suggests that as the primordial atom or whatever it was, the event that began the universe, as that expanded outward from the point where it expanded from, that sound would have organized matter. So because of small quantum differences in pressure differences in this expanding bubble of matter, there would have been some areas of slightly higher pressure than others. So you have nodes or areas of lower pressure, antinodes or areas of higher pressure within this bubble that's expanding in the universe. And it's these different areas of pressure within this bubble that's expanding that causes matter to clump together more in some areas than in others. So it's basically, the model is that sound in the early universe caused matter to clump together in some areas and not in others, which is why ultimately you have groups of galaxies here, groups of galaxies there, with vast spaces in between, with virtually no matter in between. And that is a mainstream model of how the universe was formed.
I mean, it crosses into religion as well, doesn't it, in the Bible? And then there was the Word.
Yes. How is it, you know, that ancient peoples had any kind of notion of these kind of how the universe came into being? It is extraordinary. And it's not just the Christian religion. Of course, many different religions have that same belief that sound was a creator of the universe. Even in the Egyptian religion, for example, the god Ptah spoke the universe into being. And there's a wonderful tablet in the British Museum called the Shabka Stone. And this Shabka Stone has the words of the god Ptah in hieroglyphic language, of course. It's by many people, many Egyptologists particularly, believe it to be the second most important Egyptian text, you know, beyond the Rosetta Stone. And it's in the British Museum. And it has, unfortunately, at some point in the past, somebody decided to use it as a millstone.
Oh.
So it's got a hole in the middle, oh. and a lot of the hieroglyphs have been, you know, damaged. But nevertheless, you know, there's enough of the text left to show that it's this text of the god Ptah speaking the universe into being. First there was the Word.
Wow.
And there's no question, you know, that sound is a primordial force. In fact, it's impossible to have light without sound. You have to have sound first.
Because light needs a medium to travel through.
No, it's not that so much.
No,
it's just the fact that what creates light, which is, you know, just electromagnetism is the generic term for light. But what creates electromagnetism is an event where you have two atoms or two particles of any kind that collide with each other. Hmm. That moment of that collision is when you get a release of electromagnetism. So by very definition, you can't have light without sound. You first have to have the sound, which is the collision between two particles. And then from that collision comes the release of electromagnetism, which is light.
So does a single cell, if it's all by itself, isolated, does not it not have an electromagnetic field then, if it's all by himself?
A single cell?
Yeah.
Oh, no, because cells, all life has a metabolic process, and there are collisions, you know, atomic collisions occurring all of the time within living matter. So even within a single cell, there are sounds occurring all of the time, and every living cell has its own particular sonic signature, or you could call it a song. Every cell sings, basically, and this is just a natural function of its metabolic process. So, hey, we've come from the beginning of the universe, where sound was so, according to the cosmological model, was so powerful in forming and structuring the early universe.
Mm.
And now we're talking about living cells.
We've gone from the macro world to the micro world.
We have indeed. Yes, indeed. So this whole concept of cells singing, or, you know, having some kind of a sonic signature, is the work of Professor James Jimczewski. He's at UCLA, I believe. I think he's still at UCLA, and he's a nanotechnologist. And he came up with this concept of using an atomic force microscope to listen in to the sounds of living cells. And he had great success with that. And, you know, I heard him on a radio interview one time where the presenter was extrapolating from this base point of being able to listen to the sound of cells. And where the discussion went was something like this, that let's imagine a future where you go into your doctor and you've got some kind of a tumor, a lump or whatever, and the doctor says, oh, let me take a look at that. And, oh, yes, that's a bit, we need to do something about this. So he does a little biopsy on the spot and takes a sample, in other words, of the tumor, puts it in a special little box that he has in his surgery, and presses a few buttons and looks at the readout and says, oh, yes, that's a such and such sound signature, a quite nasty one. We have to get rid of that for you. So then he simply dials in some numbers on a little probe device that he has, and he says, just lie down on the couch. This won't take a few minutes. And he basically plays the same sound that the tumor cells are making. He plays that same sound back to the tumor, but much amplified. And the result of that is, through the simple laws of resonance, because any object that is immersed in the sound field that is its own resonant frequency or frequencies, it will naturally absorb those frequencies so much more readily than any other frequencies.
And cancel itself out.
Well, effectively, right? It absorbs the energy. And what happens in the case of the tumor, if you play the sound of a tumor back to a tumor, but much amplified, then you will start, if there's enough amplification, the cells in the tumor will begin to implode. Because they're absorbing too much energy, basically. That's, you know, resonant with their own song, if you like. Of course, with this method in the future, if this method is developed, you wouldn't be able to eradicate a tumor instantly. And certainly, you know, you'd have to go back to the surgery many times for the tumor to be taken away little bit by little bit, because otherwise the body would, I guess, would go into a kind of toxic state where all this, you know, nasty
debris
basically is floating around, right, in your bloodstream, needs to be carried away and, you know, taken care of. And then you'd go back and have another session, and gradually you would shrink the tumor, basically, with this simple sonic method.
I would think that they could make literally the equivalent of a nicotine patch that's tuned to the frequency of your tumor. And maybe it's even got a dial on it, and your doctor says you're going to do the first week at level one. You know, and by the time you're at week four, we're going to crank it up to level two.
Hey.
I mean, it just seems so simple to me, this idea of sound,
yes,
healing things. It
I
seems
love the
so
simplicity.
Simple.
I love the simplicity of that concept myself. I think it's really, you know, it's an exciting possibility for the future. And so what we have done ourselves, we've taken some of the James Jimczewski's sounds. He calls this new science sonocytology, by the way. Sono obviously meaning sound, and cytology, the study of cells. And we've taken some of his sonocytology sounds and made them visible.
Right.
And one of the really interesting things that we did with the Cymascope and his sounds was he he created sound files of a cell. It was a yeast cell, actually. And then, having created this sound file, he then dropped a tiny little drop of acid, not on the cell, not directly on the cell, but very near to the cell, fringes of the cell. And the cell obviously tried to move away from the acid and screamed.
Ah.
Yes. And made made high-pitched sounds, let's say, you know, much higher-pitched sounds than its normal, healthy...
Panicked.
Kind of panicked. So would you if somebody dropped acid near you, you know.
Wow.
So anyway, what was really interesting, you know, in the lab here was when we imaged the sound of the healthy yeast cell, and we looked at that, not on the cymoscope in this case, well, we did actually image it on the cymoscope, but what was even more interesting in many ways was when we looked at the image on a conventional spectrum analyzer. So we looked at the spectrum of all the frequencies that were in that healthy yeast cell, and then we played the sounds, these screaming sounds of the yeast when the acid was dropped near it.
Like a yeast horror movie.
Yeah. And anyway, we put these through the spectrum analyzer. And what was really interesting was that all of the frequencies had shifted up the dial, so to speak. In other words, all gone to higher pitches. Why this is so interesting to me is because, you know, for many, many years before we did this experiment, people that have been interested in sound healing have said many, many times, I'd heard this in the past, that sound healing is a little bit like an orchestra that's gone out of tune. And to bring the orchestra back into tune, then you have to use certain frequencies, and gradually, you know, the orchestra comes back into tune. And so the body, you know, speaking about the body, if your body goes out of tune, you play these certain frequencies to it, and it comes back into tune, in other words, back into health.
Mm-hmm.
And I've always been suspicious of, you know, simple models. And I always thought that sound healing would have a much more complicated answer. You know, why does sound heal? And I always, you know, thought it would be quite a difficult problem to solve. And but when you look at these results from the spectrum analyzer, you realize that this simple sound of the yeast cell, when it was in a terrified state because, you know, acid had been dropped near it, it screamed in this way. All those frequencies shifted up the dial. So what we've shown there is that the frequencies from the same cell simply go higher in pitch when that cell is traumatized.
Mm.
Well, now imagine playing the sound of that cell, the healthy cell sound, back to that yeast cell. The hypothesis is that yeast cell, providing you remove the acid, of course, but that yeast cell that was screaming would return to its healthy sound state and therefore its normal healthy metabolism simply by playing that healthy sound back to its cell, back to the cell. So it's a very simple process. It would be a simple process.
I mean, it makes so much sense to me. That because it's called sympathetic resonance.
It is.
Where you play, for example, if you've got a bunch of tuning forks and you hit one, all of the tuning forks will start vibrating at the same frequency. Is that how it works?
Yes, that's simple resonance.
And also sort of, again, to me it seems so simple, like if a lady can sing a note and when her frequency of her singing voice, like Ella Fitzgerald, matches a crystal glass, the crystal glass will explode. It just seems like if we can measure the frequency of a tumor, it just seems so obvious. Zap it back with its own frequency, just like what you just said, bit by bit, and let it just explode, those tumorous cells explode.
Yes, but of course it's not a single frequency, nor was the frequencies, you know, what, nor was the sound of the yeast cell. It's a complex array of frequencies, not just one frequency. But providing, you know, you feed back all of those frequencies, just greatly amplified, you know, to a tumor, then the simple laws of resonance should apply, and the tumor should uptake those sounds far more readily. And the other wonderful thing about this concept, of course, is that healthy cells in the same vicinity, you know, as the tumor, say on the edge of the tumor, those healthy cells, providing you get the levels correct, the amplitude of the sound that you're feeding back in, if you're providing that to the right level, it should not unduly stress the cells that are on the fringe of the tumor. So you will only basically eradicate the tumor itself and there'll be no collateral damage. That's the principle that that we would love to see in the future.
I mean, I've been putting a lot of time into studying healing since my experience in 2012, and especially sound healing, because, of course, I got that incredibly dominant message that sound can heal anything and that music is the key. So I've been constantly researching this. In addition, as I then started to learn that everything has a frequency and a vibration, that started to expand into color, which also has, the colors have their own frequencies and vibration. So I would even think, again, just logically, you're with your equipment able to get this visual image with your cymoscope of a sound. So let's say your buddy with his fancy atomic microscope sends you the sound. You make that visible with your fancy gadget, and there you've got this picture that represents the frequency of a sick person's tumor. I would have even thought that you could then use that image and use even some kind of light beaming device to just totally harmlessly, with no impact on the person at all, but through their biometric field, imprinting that exact image of their tumor. I would even think that would somehow be therapeutic.
It probably would. It probably would. But, you know, the principles behind all of this are obviously not clearly understood at all. And what we've been talking about there with, by the way, I wish James Jimczewski was my buddy, but he, you know, he doesn't know me. But I know of him, obviously, and I know of his work. Anyway, the point about all of this is that sound healing, that's one aspect of sound healing where you are using a kind of destructive principle, you know, to destroy a tumor. But what about constructive sound principles? Because you can also use sound as a means of stimulating, exciting the body into a healing state. And this is, you know, getting back to where we all began with the Great Pyramid and how my back was healed. You know, what was the mechanism? Why was my back healed in those literally 3 hours within the pyramid? I crawled in there almost on my hands and knees in great pain, and I walked out a whole human being. You know, what had actually happened in that time? And so since then, which was almost 20 years ago, I've been steadily researching this subject. And it comes down to some very simple principles which have not yet been fully proven, but nevertheless, we've got a very good working hypothesis now as to how sound can heal, you know, from a constructive point of view, not destructive. And it is simply this. Well, there's two aspects to it. The first one is that when cells are traumatized by some, whether it's an invasion of pathogens or, you know, you've physically hurt yourself in some way, there's been an injury, physical injury of some kind, the cells in that particular part of the body or system of the body are traumatized. And when that happens, the cells go into a state called the G0 phase. This is, you know, known biology, basically. It's nothing new about this. But what you would find if you look up this G0 phase is that the cells are in a kind of sleep state. It's a state where they're not replicating. They're not doing what they're meant to be doing, you know, in normal replication and serving the body in whatever bodily system that they are in. They've gone to sleep, essentially. And this is what, you know, we call illness, where the body has a system that is not fully functional. It's in a kind of sleep state. Mm. And to wake the cells up again, you know, to move them from this G0 phase to what's called the G1 phase, where the cells are awake and alert and replicating and doing all their normal activities. If you look that up biologically, you will find that it's the usual way of waking up a cell that's in sleep mode is by either rest or by injection of some nutrition. You know, in other words, the cells may be lacking in some nutritive nutrients or whatever. But the hypothesis that I have is that while those, I'm sure that rest and nutrients are vitally important to the body, and what about sound?
Right.
What if sound itself, when you inject the sound, that is the medium that wakes the cell from its G0 phase?
Right.
And projects it into its G1 phase. And perhaps that is what happened to me in the pyramid, that all the cells in my lower back that were in the G0 phase, and when the cells are in this phase, you know, especially in a lower back condition, they're in a kind of, in a state where they're trying to protect the area, so they're in a spasm. And a lot of the pain that you're feeling is a result of the spasm. Mm. And so the spasm and this moving of the G0 to G1 phase can be activated by sound.
Right.
And that, I believe, is what happened. I don't believe it, but I have a strong sense that that is what happened in the pyramid. We need to do a lot more work in this area to prove it. And the work that we're doing now is at the microscopic level. So we're looking at the results of sound on the surface of living cells. And the work that we've done so far, we've began with the aloe vera plant. And we have a really excellent movie on YouTube that, you know, that your listeners could have a look into if you give the link. Mm-hmm. And it's basically showing the sounds that we created on the surface of aloe vera plant cells. And we thought it would be a good idea to start with aloe vera because it's known to have healing and curative properties anyway. But more importantly, you know, from the experimental point of view, the cells are much larger than human cells, and it's always better when you're getting into a territory that's unknown and where you're feeling your way to start with something that's a little bit easier. So we started with the aloe vera plant. It was a very successful experiment showing these patterns that occur on the surface membrane of the cell. Now, if you think about the sounds that any sound healing practitioner creates to create a healing response in someone, imagine if we could see those sounds made visible literally on the surface of the living cell,
right,
and get some insights as to what is going on. Now, one of the possible mechanisms that triggers the cell from the G0 phase into the G1 phase is the fact that every cell on its surface has hundreds of little projections called integral membrane proteins. These are the way that the cell communicates with its brother and sister cells, excretes, takes in food, excretes materials not needed, and so on. These little IMPs, as they're called, are like, if you can imagine a hedgehog with all these little protrusions on its surface, similar kind of thing. Well, when you see a pattern, a cymatic pattern, imprint itself onto the surface of a cell, as we have shown with the aloe vera plant, it's a beautiful pattern. It's symmetrical.
Mm-hmm.
As long as the sound is a beautiful sound, a harmonic sound, then the pattern will be beautiful. You know, it'll have a symmetrical appearance.
Right. Value. Snowflakey.
Like
kind
a snowflake
of
kind
of
thing,
symmetry,
yes.
Yeah.
Now imagine all those nodes and antinodes that form that pattern, and now imagine them locked in to these little integral membrane proteins that are projecting from the cell wall, and imagine those nodes and antinodes stimulating those little IMPs. Perhaps that is the mechanism that wakes the cell up, you know, and says, hey, it's okay. You don't have to be asleep now. It's okay to come back into a normal state. Maybe that's, you know, another thing we can be looking at. It's a possibility for the future.
I mean, it seems already there's so much work being done with sound healing, especially in the UK. I was pretty surprised. And I just did a course with Tony Neck, who's brilliant, whose organization is the Color of Sound. And he teaches all sorts of musical modalities of drumming and tuning forks and crystal singing bowls. And there'll be a frequency that they associate with the health of different parts of your body and different energetic centers of your body. So I would imagine in the future, I mean, as technology is increasing so rapidly, I would almost imagine it be like you see in a sci-fi movie, that there's no cutting required, that you would lie down and some ultra microphone would just listen to your body recognize where the resonances were taking place that were not normal, and then just play back the normal frequency through sympathetic resonance. Maybe it's your kidneys, and that they vibrate then at a normal rate, and maybe there's another frequency that's, if there's some bad tissue, they play that same frequency. I mean, it just seems like that would be the way of the future with technology, with the sound, with all the stuff that's being unearthed about frequencies and vibrations, and the fact that our whole bodies now are just energy. And as you said, every single cell has its own note that it's playing. So surely then the answer to health is to really be paying attention to the sound of those notes in our bodies and learn as much as we can about them so that we can make sure that they're all in their optimal resonant frequency states so that we're all happy and healthy.
Absolutely. Well, it sounds a little bit like the Star Trek bed, doesn't it? You know, that bed where the little display on the back is dancing up and down,
yeah,
and Bones is coming and bending over and saying, "Oh, yes, I see that your third layer is out of frequency here. We'll have to tweak it a little bit."
I think there was one maybe in the movie Elysium. I think they might have had a healing bed in that.
Mm. Well, the interesting thing about this, from a technical standpoint, to be able to achieve that kind of result, it probably wouldn't be literally listening to the sound of the cellular systems of the body, because there are so many extraneous sounds, that would mask the actual signal of the cells. But one of the ways that you could achieve a result would be, instead of listening to the sound of the cells, would be to use electromagnetism. You know, we were talking earlier about the fact that every cell has a metabolic process going on all of the time, and that every cell literally has a song, or, it's creating sound all of the time. You can't hear it, of course, because its level is so low. But in addition to creating sounds, of course, as I mentioned earlier, whenever you have a collision between any two atomic particles, that is a definition of sound. You're passing data on from one particle to the other at that moment of collision. But the other thing that's happening is that you're creating light. And in the case of cells, the kind of light that's being created, or the frequency band of light, is in the infrared spectrum. So all the cells in our bodies are continually generating infrared light.
Mm.
But the interesting thing about this is that the light that's being generated is actually carrying the signal of the sound with it on its back, so to speak.
Wow.
In other words, it's being modulated by the sounds in the cells.
Wow.
So in order to listen to the sounds of the cells of your body, you don't necessarily have to listen with sound.
Right.
You can listen with light.
Right.
So what you do is you monitor the infrared light coming off the body, and then you demodulate the light and retrieve the sound that's embedded in the light.
Wow.
And so that is a real potential mechanism for the future, to listen in to the body's systems,
yeah,
through the light, that your infrared light that your body is emitting.
I think I saw some work of Lynn McTaggart, some of her research, and does it make sense? I think it was in her book, The Field, that we actually give off more light when we're unwell. We literally lose our light. She had some research, and they had put people in, in the dark, and the ones that were unwell were shedding more light energy.
I haven't heard of that work. I mean, obviously, when you're unwell, you might have a temperature, for example, so your whole metabolism is upset and is creating more heat in general. But I haven't heard any of that kind of work that you've talked about.
There's another gadget that could be formed with this sort of sound diagnostics. Is one of the things I saw in Tony Neck's classes. He had somebody lie down, and I guess apparently we have all these energetic centers through our body called chakras. And apparently in all the different ancient healing modalities all around the world, everybody around the world has acknowledged these energy centers in our body. So it seems there's something to it, because everyone all around the planet is on the same page that there is this core alignment of energy centers. So Tony would lie somebody down, and he would hold, it could have been tuning forks or in this case a crystal singing bowl, and he holds it over each energy center along the person's body. And I witnessed it with my own eyes and my own ears, that he was able to recognize imbalances in the person's well-being by the behavior of the sound of the crystal singing bowl. Because crystal, I guess, as I'm sure you know, is very resonant with the human body because we have this crystalline matrix structure in our tendons, I believe, is where it lurks the most, is in everything that strings us together. So our own bodies affect these crystal singing bowls when they're played. And he would move it along the body. And in some places, the bowl sound would amplify. And in other places, the bowl's beautiful sound would be muted very quickly. And I will throw a disclaimer here that I might have remembered it the reverse, but it's either that when it gets louder, that energy center in your body is underactive, or I think that's the one. I think it's underactive, and so it's allowing the crystal bowl to go nuts with its own frequency. I think that's the correct one, but disclaimer, it could be the other way around.
Well, Annalise and I have noticed this many, many times. There's a wonderful company in the USA called Cymatics.
Sounds like something out of the X-Files, can I just say? Mulder.
Cymatechnology. C-Y-M-A Technologies.
Where's J.J. Abrams when you need him?
Inc. Anyway, many years ago, they used to be called Cymatherapy, and now they're rebranded and called Cymatechnologies. We still have one of their original sound healing machines, and it outputs hundreds of different codes or combinations of sounds that are used for various maladies. And there's a manual that comes with it. And you literally, look up whatever it is that's ailing you.
Wow.
Dial it in. And it supports the body in, to back to normal health, back to healing. And it's very, very effective. And one of the things, we were in Atlanta in October, November last year, where I gave a talk. And one of the things that was clearly demonstrated to us by one of the Cymatechnologies practitioners, and we've since noticed this effect ourselves, is that exactly as you say, when you play, you were talking about a Tibetan bowl, right?
This was actually a crystal singing bowl opposed to a metal
one. Yeah, okay. So it's a crystal bowl. But the same principles apply. When you play a specific sound to a specific body part, when that body part that's obviously you're playing it to a body part because it has some reason for that. It's you have an illness, you have a pain, you whatever it is. But when you play the sound of that body part for a few minutes, let's say, you notice the sound change. Mm. Literally, the sound changes when that body part is effectively saying, hey, I've had enough of this sound now. And, we can imagine what is actually happening here at the cellular level quite simply because the sound, as you know, the body is a very high percentage of water, anywhere between 70-80%, depending on what age you are. So water uptakes sonic frequencies very readily, as we see in the Cymascope device every day. But what happens is that when water uptakes sonic frequencies, it literally holds on to those frequencies. So if you continue to put those same frequencies into the water becomes effectively charged with those frequencies, okay? So in the process where you're feeding a sound into the body, either via a crystal bowl or a Tibetan bowl or some other form of musical instrument, or in this case with the Cymatechnologies, technological method, however you create the sound is really doesn't matter to the principle here, that the body will absorb a certain amount of that energy, those various frequencies, and then when it's engorged, it's completely charged with those frequencies, it starts to reflect back to the, in this case, the Cymatechnologies applicator, the kind of transducer that you're holding near the skin of your body. It reflects those sounds back. Because they're already fully charged.
Mm.
But before that moment of reflection back, they're actually still absorbing the energy.
Right.
So there's a very simple principle behind why you hear this difference in sound.
Mm.
The cells have literally become fully charged with those frequencies. And in any case, getting back to Cymatechnologies, it's a wonderful machine and Annalise and I use it very regularly and supports us in many, many different ways.
Yeah. And that's, I guess, anybody can buy that online?
No, I think this, the way the Cyma Technologies company operate is that they work with practitioners.
Okay.
So people that are helping other people, okay, they're supporting other people. And so I don't think, you know, you would have to become a practitioner to be able to access one of their machines.
I'm already halfway to being a practitioner, I'll have you know. I'm certified in crystal singing bowls and now colour therapy. What are you guys? We've got to... What are you guys heckling?
It's available, apparently.
Oh, it is available.
Is it available?
Now it is.
Oh, now it is. Now,
update. Breaking news.
Breaking news is that Cyma Technologies AMI 1000 instrument is now available to anyone who wants to access it.
Do you have any idea what it costs?
I don't know.
Is it crazy expensive? I mean, is it thousands of dollars?
Well, I think they're fairly expensive because obviously there's a lot of electronics in them.
Wow.
And they're... You know, one of the things about electronics apparatus is that I think we're all so spoiled by stuff coming out of China and the Far East in general that's been manufactured by the million. And so there are obviously huge cost savings, you know, when that happens. Whereas when a small manufacturer like Cyma Technologies or our own company, you know, cymascope.com, when we manufacture something, you know, we can't have those cost savings. So naturally, the price is higher.
Right.
But you're getting a very special piece of apparatus,
yeah,
that's for sure.
Right. Mm. Wow, that's really interesting. I'll have to get the link and make sure I post it along with this.
Wonderful.
Excellent. I'm just curious, since we're talking about the sound healing and stuff, there's a certain frequency that comes up a lot once you go onto YouTube, which personally I think is marvelous because there's so many videos about this stuff on YouTube that I don't know if anybody would ever put on television, but they're on YouTube. And this frequency 432 hertz keeps coming up. And it apparently is this sort of ancient frequency. Was it Pythagoras who came up with the solfeggio scale? Is that right?
Well, 432 hertz is a really interesting subject. I certainly haven't got fully to the bottom of it yet. I've done quite a lot of research into it because, like you know, I've seen a lot of great videos on YouTube and Vimeo and other places. I've read a lot of articles on the subject, and many of them make all sorts of astonishing claims about this number, this 432 hertz. And so it certainly got my attention. I dug into it quite deeply in terms of, you know, doing research to find out how this number came about in the first place. And so I wrote a whole article on the subject. It's actually part one of a two-part article. And part one is already available on our website.
Mm.
It's called The Curious Concert Pitch Debate.
Oh,
is what
right.
It's called, which is a very odd title. But anyway, that's what we came up with. And it is a debate. It's going on all around the world.
That's right.
You know, people are talking about this number. So I dug quite deeply into it. And certainly I found out a lot of really excellent information and was able to satisfy myself, you know, as to how it came about. But the question as to whether it is actually a beneficial pitch, you know, in terms of health. This is a really big question. It's not easy to answer that question. But one of the ways that I already have a kind of sense of 432 hertz is because of the Cymascope app that we created. You know, this is the app where it's not a real Cymascope, but it's all the imagery within the Cymascope app was created on a real, you know, laboratory Cymascope. And what you notice in the Cymascope app is that when you play any of the notes in 440 tuning, and then you switch to 432 tuning and you do a comparison between the two. So what we're seeing here, we're hearing the piano note, and then we're seeing its visual equivalent, you know, its cymatic or its cymoscopic equivalent in the center of the screen. So you hear the note and you see the note. And then if you make a comparison between any note in 440 and the same note in 432, or indeed in the other tuning pitch that the app has, which is 444 hertz, which is another interesting pitch, if you make those comparisons, what you find is the pitch which is the least stable creates the least stability in the cymatic patterns, the cymoscope patterns, is 440. Now, Why should that be? You know, I honestly don't know the answer to that right now, but it's certainly worthy of investigation. It's a very complex subject area. You know, cymatics in general is extraordinarily complex. You know, we've spoken with mathematicians who have said it would take 10 years of mathematical work to develop an explanation, a model of what the cymoscope does. You know, these amazing patterns that occur. No physicist in the world right now or mathematician could describe what the cymoscope does. It's that complex. And so, you know, but getting back to 432 hertz, so understanding why 432 might be more beneficial than some other tuning frequency, such as 440, is a huge, you know, huge challenge.
I mean, to give listeners just a bit of scope on why I even brought it up, correct me if I'm wrong, but for as long as we've had some sort of standardization in musical notes around the world, they called it concert pitch. So all the musical instruments around the world, an A would be 432 hertz. And this has been for kind of as long as we can remember, ever since people used to wander around villages where they would simply tune their instruments to the local church bell, which I heard is how they used to do it. Way back in the day when there were traveling bands, they would play the church bell and tune from that. So the sound would go with the local village.
I hadn't heard that.
But then we evolved and there was this standardization as everything evolves, but something mysterious happened. And it was right around 1939, I believe, that they changed the concert pitch standard from 432 hertz to 440 hertz. And there's actually even conspiracy theories about this. Even I've heard Hitler's man Joseph Goebbels being brought into the fray, that it was his plan, and he had even talked about it to do in wartime, that this frequency creates a very unhealthy frequency in our own brains that's not as effective as, for example, with the 432 hertz. And I believe the difference might have even, I guess it's, yeah, it's 8 hertz is the difference.
Yeah, well, let me...
So go ahead. You take over with probably far more accuracy than mine.
Let me just set the record straight away, because there was no concert pitch that was an international standard before the 1939 meeting that you're referring to. Many different orchestras around the world had their own concert pitches, and there was no standardization.
Okay.
And that did make it very difficult, particularly when you remember that around that time, when you think back, I'm not suggesting that you would actually remember, but when you think back to those days is when recordings were first starting to be shared around the world in the form of vinyl records, okay? So imagine the complexities, you know, the problems that would cause when one orchestra is playing at one pitch and then another orchestra is playing at an entirely different pitch. So there had to be a standard. And it was a great thing, you know, that they did decide ultimately to create a standard. Whether 440 is the correct standard is still, you know, the jury's still out on that subject. But it was not 432 hertz before that moment in history. There were multiple, you know, standards all around the world, all conflicting. And so that's one thing that needs to be said. The other thing is that Goebbels did attend that meeting, but he was only one vote. He was the German vote, right? And there was a meeting there that, you know, had dozens of different nations were represented in that meeting. So one vote could not possibly influence the whole of the meeting. And I also read, like you did, you know, that this conspiracy theory that the Nazis wanted to have 440 hertz as the standard in order to create hysteria. And, it doesn't make any sense to me. Why, you know, even if Goebbels could have influenced the committee, you know, to 440, why would you want to incite hysteria among the public?
I thought it was more like dumbing people down, making your brain just not think so clearly.
Oh, well,
creating
more
confusion in your mind.
I heard it was hysteria, but I just couldn't figure that either. It didn't seem logical that the Nazis would want to create those kind of aggressive and hysterical aspects to in society. Anyway, it didn't make any sense to me. And when I looked into it all and I found that Goebbels was there by himself, you know, he only had one vote in the final count. How could he possibly have influenced it? Anyway, it's a really interesting subject area. I do think there is more to it than meets the eye. I need to do a lot more work with the Cymascope and studying the differences between these different frequencies, between our pitches, you know, 440 pitch versus 432 mm-hmm. and 444, the other pitch which is being talked about in the world a lot. 444 is the pitch supposedly of love. Mm. On the piano, it creates, one of the keys is 528 hertz. And that's been hailed as a frequency that repairs DNA.
That's
right. You know, all these different ideas come up. But when you follow the thread back, you can't get to any actual concrete information. There's no information that's telling you something that some wonderful research has been done by some laboratory on these frequencies and have found this and this. There's nothing. There's no substance to it. So someone needs to do this research, and I'm certainly up for it. I've already done a lot, and there's a lot more to do yet. But it's certainly interesting about the app, how when you look at the notes on 440 and you compare them with 432 and 444, there's no question the 440 notes are nowhere near as stable as the other
that's
as
really
the other
interesting.
Pitches. Yes.
Is it that there's more sustain, it lasts longer on a 432, or is it just more the clarity of the image that you're getting, the difference?
Well, it's an interesting thing. It's quite a complex area and a difficult thing to talk about, but especially when your listeners haven't actually seen, you know, Cymascope imagery.
Oh, I will make sure they do.
Well, let me try to describe it, but you might struggle. I mean, it's a difficult concept. But when if you look on the app, for example, and you play a given note, let's say you play A4, 440 or whatever, when you play that note, you will see a pattern form immediately on the screen. And then a moment or two later, the pattern almost disappears. It goes into kind of a set of concentric circles, say, and then the pattern reappears, and then it disappears, and then it reappears, and it's oscillating between these two states, between concentric circles and then a full pattern. You know, why is that? And then when you switch the app to 432 tuning and you do the same thing, then the effect is still there a little bit, but nowhere near as dominant as in the 440. Now let's talk about what is actually happening here. If we get down to the nitty-gritty, when you play a note on a piano, or if you play it on any instrument for that matter, but let's focus on the piano, because these notes that are in the app were created originally on a piano. And in a piano, almost all of the strings are in sets of three. Only the lower bass strings are single strings. All of the other strings in a piano are in groups of three. So when you strike a piano string, you press the key and you hear the note, you're not hearing one frequency. You're hearing a whole host of frequencies, multiple frequencies, not just because there are three strings, but also because the strings are creating harmonics. These are multiples of the fundamental pitch of the string. So you've got a fundamental pitch, and then you've got a whole series of harmonics. And it's these harmonics, really, in the end, that tell us that we're listening to a piano as opposed to listening to the same note on a violin or the same note on a trumpet or whatever. You know, the harmonics tell the ear-brain mechanism what instrument that note is coming from. It's the quality, the timbre of the note is created by the harmonics. But these harmonics are not stationary, they're not static. They are coming and going. They're mixing and mingling in the strings of the piano. And so the note itself is not static. If you strike a note on a piano and then really close your eyes and really focus all of your attention onto that note, you'll hear it's mixing and mingling all the time. It's changing and changing and changing. And what happens in the Cymascope, and indeed you can see it in the Cymascope app, is that when you inject, say, this piano note sound into water, which is the medium that we use in the Cymascope, when you eject it into the water, the little ripples on the surface of the water travel outward from the center of the water area. It's a very small area of water, but they travel quickly outward and they reflect off the circular boundary of what we call the visualizing cell, which is the cell that contains the water. And when they reflect backwards, they create what is typically known as a standing wave pattern, this beautiful pattern that is an analog or a model, you could say, of that sound. It's this, literally the sound made visible. Well, what then happens is, as the sound of the piano string, we're doing this in real time, don't forget, this is an actual piano string being struck, you know, we're pressing the key, we're hearing the sound, and the decay of a piano sound string is quite long. I mean, some of them are like 20 seconds, you know, it'd be from the strike to the final decay. All of that time, the harmonics of the string are mixing and mingling, and you can hear it with your own ears. But what the cymoscope is seeing, and when it sees all these mixing and minglings, it's seeing moments when the harmonics change and become out of phase, what's called out of phase, with the original sounds that were created. Mm. And these little phase differences cancel out the original ripples on the water's surface. So this is why these little cancellations of phase cancellations are why you see the image come and go and, you know, come and go, and it continues like that for quite a few seconds. But you don't see that effect anywhere near as significantly in 432 hertz. Hmm. Now, why is that, Natalie?
Well, you tell me. You're the smarty pants.
I wish I knew the answer.
I'm just a podcaster. God.
I wish I knew the answer. I don't actually know the answer. But there must be an answer. There must be a reason. And this is why, you know, we need to do a lot more research into 432 hertz. So currently, you know, I'm one of the many people who are kind of sitting on the fence. You know, the jury is out. But I do see something. I see a reason to carry on doing more work, to investigate it further. It's definitely got my attention. And I'm convinced that there is something in 432 hertz, but I don't know.
Right.
I haven't been able to identify it.
So some conspiracy potentially, but it could be a benign conspiracy, right?
Well, you know, originally it was all because the number 432 hertz, you know, when you divide it and divide it and divide it, it divides beautifully equally, you know, way back to 1 hertz. Hmm. So there's a neatness in the mathematics. But does it go further than that neatness in the mathematics? And I'm getting the sense that actually it does. But I wouldn't want to say more than that right now.
Oh, I can read it in your face. I'll be typing my own, what do you call it, the after log of this, my beliefs on this. Uh-huh. Well, you bring up something that I wanted to ask you about anyway. When you talk about the math, this is something else I've been, you know, poring over, and I've stumbled, I'm sure you'll know, of the vortex mathematics.
Mm, of course.
Which is this, for some reason it is associated with Nikola Tesla. I don't know if he discovered it or if he was just a fan of its elegance or its mystery. Mm. But it's this way that you do math and somehow it creates a pattern. If you write these numbers down, it's got like a W shape as you maybe draw the numbers in a circle. And the numbers 3, 6, and 9 don't get struck by this little W shape. And then the numbers 3, 6, 9 keep becoming very significant because they're used so much in our world with time and calendars and circles and the geometry. So I guess there's a link, of course, with geometry and with sound, because there's the frequencies and the musical notes. So I wondered what were your thoughts on the connection. And you hear so much about sacred geometry and the Platonic solids, where there's only these, is it 5 shapes that form everything in our known universe? Mm. You'd know them all. I only know the very basic ones. But that all those 5 shapes, when you break down their angles, the number happens to make the tone that makes this perfect solfeggio scale. Is that correct?
Well, you've read a lot on this subject, and there is a lot to read on this subject. And by the way, I have never come to the bottom of 3, 6, 9 with Tesla. I've never found that quote anywhere. I looked for it online, like everyone else. But I don't find any original reference to him saying that, which is interesting, isn't it?
Well, there's the quote that he supposedly said was, if you can understand the magnificence of 369, you will understand the key to the universe.
Yes, I know. It's a great quote.
And it's repeated everywhere, right? But you're saying you can't.
It's a great quote.
Find the origin.
I haven't found the origin of that quote. It's odd. But I'm not saying he didn't say it, just that I've never... You know, when you're writing an article, as I've written a lot of articles, you have to research.
Right, have a source.
You have to have sources so that you can annotate and so on. And in that case, I've never actually found it. But anyway, talking about the general subject of sound and geometry, one of the very amazing things that happened in the laboratory here a few years ago was that we created a torus in the water, a subsurface water. So I think a lot of your listeners will probably be surprised to know that these kind of cymatic patterns that we see that are so beautiful, and, you know, very many of them look like snowflakes, mm-hmm. they're so intricate and absolutely gorgeous to behold, that they are not just occurring on the surface of the water, that the pattern actually goes all the way through the depth of the water. And we realized this a few years ago in the laboratory, working with the Merion team of scientists. In one of the experiments that we did, we were able to create a torus in the water. This was an amazing moment for us all here, because we'd never seen anything like it. But it was literally in the depth of the water, this torus. And of course, you know, toroidal mathematics are very complex. And yet here, you know, nature in the cymoscope, using very simple principles, all we have is a small visualizing cell with, you know, filled with water, and we are exciting it with a voice coil motor. And in this case, it was a very low frequency that we were using. So all the elements of the experiment were extraordinarily simple. And yet what was being created was something that mathematically is, you know, complex and beautiful to behold, you know, to see a torus in the water.
What sound were you making?
It was very low frequency sound, because the Merion prime frequency is 7.97 hertz. And we were experimenting with frequencies around that area, you know, to see, because the Merion pattern itself occurs at 7.97 hertz. And that's a very beautiful pattern. And we were experimenting around that area. And one of the other amazing things that happened with the Merion scientists was that we created a knot in water. And this got everyone very excited as well. How can you possibly have a knot created in water? But we did. And we were able to duplicate it, you know. So it's another really exciting result. And why I was so thrilled about both of those results, you know, the torus and the knot in the water, is because it was showing the ability of sound to structure water. Mm. Not just to imprint a pattern on the surface of water, but to actually structure within the water itself. And now imagine the implications of that fact, because it is a fact. Imagine the implications of that fact on the human condition, the human body, because it means that every sound around us in the environment is impacting us, not just with our hearing, you know, and maybe if we're immersed in a low frequency sound field, we might feel it, you know, in our bodies, in our lungs or whatever. Yes, of course, you always get those kind of physical effects of low frequency sounds in your body. And of course, if it's a loud sound, you might be wanting to cover your ears because, you know, it's uncomfortable or whatever. We all know we've had those moments in our lives. But just think that every single sound around us, regardless of what it is, whether it's being created by beautiful music or whether it's the traffic outside your home or whatever it is all having an impact on your body. And I don't just mean in the sense of vibration. I mean it's creating patterns in the fluids, in the water within your body. And, you know, this is a fact. Right. Now, we've proven this through the work that we've done with the cymoscope, that sound creates structure in water within the body of the water itself. Now, what this means for biology, ultimately, human biology and other forms of biology, we don't know. We can extrapolate from that and say it almost certainly will have some significance in the future, but we just don't know right now. But it's just an interesting fact that sound creates structure in water.
Also, thanks to, I guess, predominantly a lot of research by Dr. Emoto, he also was able to prove that intention can structure water as well, because he had his intention experiments where he would put, you know, on a bottle of water the word love or the word hate and then freeze it and look at the little molecules of frozen water under the microscope. And the ones with the good intentions were beautiful, stunning snowflake formations. And the ones with a bad intention were these tortured, twisted, vulgar-shaped patterns, you know?
Well, we actually are beginning to find similar results ourselves to Dr. Emoto. Of course, Dr. Emoto worked, he's now passed. It's the late Dr. Emoto, very sadly. But he did some wonderful work, which, like our own work, you know, has been heavily criticized. Dr. Emoto's work has also been heavily criticized. I'm talking now, you know, the scientific community. And the reason for that is, in his case, because of his apparent lack of controls. You know, a lot of people have criticized him for not having controls in his experiments. And so, you know, what can you really believe from the experiments? This is what, you know, the critics are saying.
So when you say no control, you mean there was no water that had no intention on it? He just put intentions on water.
Well, not only that. You know, if you read in his books, there's no information about methodologies beyond the basic, you know, use of the microscope with frozen water at such and such a temperature. There's not any detail regarding how many samples were tested before this given result was found, and how many were rejected, and so on. Those kind of statistical analyses should have been done. But nevertheless, you know, you still cannot discount all of the work that he did. No way. I mean, there's some very valuable work was done there, and we are now finding similar kinds of results ourselves in the lab here. You know, when I'll give you an example. On a daily basis, one of the ways that we support our research is with what we call the voice mandala product. It is one sends in their sound file, their voice sounds, and we make the voice sound visible. You know, it's quite a simple process. We put it into the Cymascope, create this beautiful pattern from the person's voice. It's always beautiful, by the way. You know, this is the thing. A lot of people think their voice isn't beautiful. Some people, you know, are not happy with their voice. But the reality is, from the cymoscopic point of view, all voices are beautiful. So we make it visible, and then we colorize it according to the customer's choices and send it back to them as a file. So that's a service that we offer, and it does help to support our research, you know, the little bit of revenue that we get that way. But anyway, the reason I'm mentioning it is because what we often find is that a person's activities in their life will somehow infer into the pattern that occurs. Mm. A prime example of this was the day when someone sent us their voice file, and in the center of the pattern was what looked like a tooth.
Oh,
and I know it was a very strange thing. It just looked like a tooth. It wasn't actually sent. It wasn't sent to us in this case by the customer themselves. It was sent to us by one of our agents who had recorded this sound of this person. And I try as I may, I couldn't. You know, I tweaked the EQ controls and tried to remove this strange anomaly in the central part of the image, and it wouldn't go away. So in the end, I just thought, well, that's that person's voice. That's what it is. And I sent it back to our agent in this case, and he wrote back kind of jokingly saying, "There's absolutely no problem, John. This friend of ours is a dentist." You see, so...
Again, forensic tools,
Tools, you know. Now, how on earth, you know, can that happen? And I could, you know, I could recount many, many other times when this has happened, where information coming from a person's career or lifestyle or whatever has actually been inferred in the imagery. And then the other really interesting aspect of all of this that, again, has implications for Dr. Omoto's work is my own thoughts, how my own thoughts can influence the water. And so a prime example of this is the day that I decided to image the voice of the singer Sting. And he had this track called, I think it's called That's Not the Shape of My Heart or something like that. And I'd always loved the track, and I thought, oh, I'd love to see what this looks like visible, made visible. And I had this absolute thought, Natalie, that wouldn't it be wonderful if the image turned out to be, when he says the word heart...
It's a heart.
It turned out to be a heart.
Yeah.
And it did.
Wow.
Now, obviously, the thought that passed through my mind that at that time was, you know, I made that happen. I had the thought.
Oh, because you were projecting.
I wanted that to happen. And so I projected my thought on the water, and it happened. Now, they are just two instances, but, you know, I could recount many, many instances where I've had a thought and it has resulted in a specific pattern. So, again, this is all, you know, anecdotal. We haven't done this on a scientific basis. It's just what I'm noticing on a day-to-day basis in the lab. And so this is why I started to, you know, take a real interest in Dr. Omoto's work, the work that he did, and would like to begin a series of experiments that are carefully controlled.
Yeah, definitely.
In which I'm not the person, you know, influencing the water. There would be some other, you know, third party that's involved, that's projecting their thoughts.
Get someone listening to Sting, Shape of My Heart, and then someone putting together IKEA furniture. And you could measure.
Where do you come up with these ideas, Natalie?
I think that would be two ends of the spectrum.
Oh, yes.
To get the imagery. And then there would be in the IKEA one in the middle, the missing Allen key.
Oh, I see. Oh, the missing Allen key. The famous missing Allen key.
Your bit that's not there.
Yes, I know. But anyway, it's something that we would love to do in the future.
I think that sounds wonderful. You could have a whole book with all the different images of, you know, different thoughts. You could try reading different poems and listening to different music. You know, what would the pattern look like listening to the Beatles versus, you know, a heavy metal band?
Absolutely. But it would need to be carefully controlled. And, you know, we don't want a repeat of, you know, the kind of criticism that that poor Dr. Omoto suffered. It needs to be carefully controlled so that the results are taken seriously. It also needs to be monitored, you know, by some known and respected scientist, so that no, you know, shroud of criticism can be cloaked over the results.
With all the stuff that I keep looking up, one thing that keeps popping up as well is the Schumann resonance, which apparently is at 7.83 hertz, the pulse of the planet.
Yeah, 7.83 hertz.
And have you done a Cymascope of that frequency to see what it would look like?
We have. As a matter of fact, you see these little boxes to your side here. If you just open those boxes.
Wow, I had one right by me.
Oh, well, actually, you've opened exactly the right box. Now, that actually isn't 7.83 hertz. But what it is, these are little coasters that have the pattern of a harmonic of 7.83
hertz. It's super beautiful.
It is beautiful. It's a harmonic of the Schumann cavity resonance. In other words, a multiple of that frequency.
Wow.
And it is absolutely gorgeous.
Yeah.
It's gorgeous to behold. And one of the interesting things, you know, Schumann cavity resonance, for listeners who don't know what it is, there is between the ionosphere and the surface of the Earth, there's a kind of cavity. And this cavity effectively locks in low-frequency electromagnetism. So no one really understands where this electromagnetism comes from. You know, one of the theories is that it is a net result of lightning storms around the planet. I don't really buy that. It doesn't feel right to me that lightning storms would always create this, you know, this same kind of low pitch, 7.83 hertz. But anyway, you know, no one knows, and I don't know, what causes this low frequency. But I've read papers that suggest that this low frequency, 7.83 hertz, has been around since the beginning of life on Earth. It's always been there, in other words. And even to the extent that it has influenced the brains of all mammals, because if you think about it, all mammals, or life for that matter, have been immersed in that electromagnetic field all of that time. So it is a very low frequency micro pulsations of the Earth's own static magnetic field. You know that we have the magnetic field of the Earth, which is a static field. But if you like, on the back of that static field is this tiny little pulsation, which is 7.83 hertz. And it's not, that isn't the only frequency. There are actually a whole band of Schumann resonances, but that is the primary frequency. That's the one in which it has the most amplitude. And we used a multiple of that to create that beautiful pattern that you saw on the coaster there.
Is it the ionosphere? Is that what Tesla tapped into for his free energy experiments? Or that was what his plan was?
That was what his plan was.
Yeah.
He also, you know, Tesla was an absolutely brilliant, brilliant man. He wanted to, one of the things that I really did not go along with, you know, when I learned about it, was Tesla wanted to send electricity through the air. Did you hear about that?
Yes. To electrify the planet.
Well, it wouldn't have been a good thing to do. You know, he was brilliant and had some fantastic ideas, but it wouldn't have been good for the planet. It would have ionized the atmosphere, and it would have caused all sorts of harmful effects for people.
Have you seen, there's a really excellent documentary by a guy named James Russell, who I think he's a British filmmaker, and it's called Resonance, Beings of Frequency. Have you seen that?
No, I haven't.
You would love it. I definitely encourage everyone to check it out. The predominant message is the harmful side of cellular technology, cell phones. But in it, they talk about this Schumann resonance, and somebody did an experiment back in the 50s where they put a bunch of university students in a bunker and they deprived them of this frequency, this 7.83 megahertz, and everybody got really sick. And of course, straight away, I'm thinking, well, they're sick because they're in a bunker. But then they brought a gadget in that gives that frequency. I know what that is. It's a secret frequency. We're being listened into, John.
No, it's just a pump kicking in the lab here.
It's the Men in Black.
Sorry,
they
about
won
that.
My idea for resonant gravestones. So he puts a gadget into the bunker of the planet's pulse, and everybody gets better again. And it shows that people really need this. They literally need to be in nature to stay healthy. And
I hadn't heard of that experiment, but NASA did the same thing. You know, they found that that when astronauts went outside the field of Mother Earth, so to speak, that they did suffer consequences. You know, they got sick. And they discovered in the end that the reason was because they were being deprived of this very low frequency pulsation.
Yeah.
And so for, I don't think it's a very severe effect for short term missions. You know, just a mission to the moon that lasts a week or two is not going to cause any kind of major sickness. But I know they've investigated it significantly for long missions to Mars that are being obviously planned right now. And so I think the concept is that they would need to put it back into the spacecraft, put the frequency into the spacecraft artificially, so to speak, so that the people, the astronauts, don't get sick.
Yeah, one of the big side effects, apparently, of when you don't have access to be immersed in that frequency is depression, which really would send a very loud message. I think that, you know, if you feel depressed, getting out into nature is like washing your whole energetic being with the pulse of the planet, which apparently keeps us mentally very healthy and matches with our own brainwave and the healthy frequency of our own brains. So does that make sense to you?
It absolutely does make sense. And you've triggered something for me as well, regarding the sounds of nature that I think your listeners would probably find quite interesting. And that is that if you have a walk by the seashore, you probably don't know that you're actually being bathed in ultrasound. You know, this is high frequency sound. And obviously, when you hear the sounds of waves crashing, it's a beautiful kind of rhythmic sound, isn't it? And in fact, I know that you can even buy radios that send you to sleep, you know, sound devices that send you to help you to go to sleep at night with the sound of the ocean waves. But in this case, I'm talking about the white noise that is created when waves break on the seashore. Mm. That white noise is not creating sounds only in the spectrum that we can hear. It's also creating ultrasound that we can't hear. In other words, high frequencies that go way beyond the 20,000 hertz that even a child can hear. These sounds go up to sort of 60,000 or even 80,000 hertz. And what's interesting about that is that ultrasound is, of course, very healing. It's very, very beneficial to the body. So wherever you can, if you can get into nature where there's a source of ultrasound, such as the seashore, such as a waterfall, or a very busy stream, where there's a lot of, just out the back of our home here, there's a lovely little stream, and we can take an ultrasound meter. You don't even have to point the meter at the stream. Anywhere in that area, you're being bathed in very high levels of ultrasound, which are obviously, is known to be healing.
Yeah.
And the strange thing about this is that no one, again, understands the mechanism behind how ultrasound heals, right?
Yeah.
It's been used since the 1950s as a healing modality in hospitals and sports injury clinics. If you go in with some kind of a torn tendon or a muscle tear or whatever, they may well offer you ultrasound, and they apply this applicator to your body and move it. They keep moving it around because you're not allowed to keep it in one spot. It can overheat the tissues. But as long as you keep moving the applicator around, you're receiving, good quantities of ultrasound. And the result of that is that the soft tissues heal far more quickly. Wow. The tendons heal far more quickly. If you have a bone fracture that is disturbed in the course of the normal healing process, say you've broken your arm, and you go to the hospital and they, put you in a cast and so on. And then you're naughty. You do something that you shouldn't have done with your broken arm and you disturb that fracture. Well, what happens in nature, for some reason, the body just doesn't want to heal that fracture. It will, even though it's in a cast, it will not heal. And so when that sort of situation occurs, you've been a naughty person with your broken arm or whatever, you go and they give you ultrasound, and that kickstarts the healing process again, so that the broken bone, the fracture will heal in a normal way. So ultrasound is a really powerful modality, but no one understands the fundamental principles behind it. You can read books. We've got lots of books on it. They put forward all sorts of hypotheses as to how it might work, but no one for sure knows how it heals the body.
It also makes sense why people say, to go to the sea. They don't understand, I'm sure, anything about ultrasonic healing things, but they'll say, oh, if you're feeling not well, go to the seaside for a bit.
That is true.
Even doctors, in Los Angeles, I'm part of an organization called Pet Partners. And when I'm there with my dog, when we can, we volunteer in hospitals and you get to hear stories of patients. And I met an English lady in there, an elderly lady, and she was telling me how she had gotten a very unusual eye disorder when she was a little girl and she was going blind and she lived in London and her dad was a really well-off theatre owner with all very successful theatres in London. And the doctor, she was maybe 8 years old, and the doctor said, she's going to go blind unless you go and live by the sea.
Oh, wow.
And so he sold up his London theatres and he moved the whole family to the seaside and she never went blind.
That's astonishing.
Yeah. So that, and I always wondered, what's behind that? And I thought maybe is it salt in the air, salt water?
Well, there are all sorts of aspects to living by the sea. I mean, apart from the ultrasound that we've talked about, you have the negative ions, which again are basically the collisions between water molecules create lots and lots of negative ions. These are atoms that are negatively charged. And they apparently have, healing benefits, people, or healthy benefits anyway. Mm. People, you've probably seen these little ionizer devices that you can buy and you put them on in your, you switch them on in your home and they produce negative ions. Mm. And they do smell a little bit like ocean, the ocean smell, that your typical smell that you have when you're by the ocean, and are supposedly beneficial for health. But also there's more oxygen in the air, when you go to the ocean, there's a lot more oxygen again because of the water action. Good exercise as well, of course. walking along the seashore is nice exercise. You're getting lots of oxygen, lots of negative ions, and lots of ultrasound. Who knows what's actually the, you know, the main factor? It probably is the ultrasound, but that's just my basic instinct, you know, kicking in.
Well, I may be willing to release you from the interview soon, but I found something interesting reading about you, and I was like, what? Which I love when I find these things, and it was to do with the Da Vinci Code.
Oh.
So how is it that this is on your website, that your technology remotely is involved with this documentary about decoding the Da Vinci Code?
Yes. Well, we had some filmmakers here in the lab. I don't know, is it a couple of years ago, Annalise? I can't remember exactly when it was, but it might have been 3 years ago now. Time seems to fly. Anyway, they came here specifically because of Roslyn Chapel. You know, this is the chapel that's just south of Edinburgh. It's quite famous all over the world, and I'm sure a lot of your American listeners will probably already have heard of it.
Is this where they think the Holy Grail is?
Yes, that's right. Exactly. All exactly. Right. The Holy of Holy
Not Grail. That I'm a conspiracy theorist, but
no,
that's where it is right, though, John.
Anyway, Roslyn Chapel is a beautiful little chapel. I mean, it's gorgeous to behold. There's an area inside the chapel called the Lady Chapel. And from the ceiling of the Lady Chapel, or if I'm remembering this correctly, 216 little cubes of stone that have been carved.
216, half of 432.
Oh, that's a...
Ooh. Just saying.
Gosh. That's not... Well, it's not half, is it? Oh, it is. It is. You're right. Oh, gosh.
It's the first time ever I've gotten something mathematical right.
Wow.
I hadn't
realized that before. Anyway, so on the faces of these little stone cubes that are hanging off the ceiling, looking extremely attractive, are what look like cymatic patterns on the surface of each side of the cube. And so for many, many years, a lot of people have noticed this and said, you know, they look like cymatic patterns or they look like Chladni patterns, same thing. Some people had tried to decode these patterns and sadly, you know, didn't manage to do so. But then our friends, Stuart and Thomas Mitchell, who actually live in Edinburgh, who are musicians, they managed to achieve exactly that. They did decode the patterns.
What did it say?
And it didn't say anything in terms of, you know, words, but what it did was, oh, here, look, here's one of the cubes.
We've got, so, I'm holding a cube.
Yeah, the filmmaker actually presented us with this the day that they came. The masons at Roslyn Chapel apparently made that cube. And the filmmaker was extremely generous in donating it to us. And they're quite small, aren't they? They're smaller than you would expect. I mean, it fits in your hand, you know, quite neatly. And there's a pattern on each side, each face.
They also seem very simple patterns.
Yes, they are very simple patterns.
Like
but
a triangle.
If you look at that pattern there, if you look edge on there, you'll see something very similar to what we showed you a little bit earlier.
On the plate.
On the Chladni plate here.
Yeah.
So anyway, to cut a long story short, our friends Stuart and Thomas did decode. And what they found was that it's a melody.
Wow.
And the reason that other people in the past had not been able to decode this melody that's embedded in the Lady Chapel cubes is because they weren't musicians? I don't know.
Right.
But the point here was that some of these cubes had been broken in history, and the masons, whoever was, you know, tasked with the job of fixing them, had put them back in the wrong places.
Oh.
They'd mixed them up, in other words. Now, if you're not a musician and you're trying to decode something that's a musical language, and yet here we have notes that are effectively in the wrong place, then no wonder you wouldn't be able to make much sense of it. But if you're a musician and you're reading music on a regular basis and you're reading these Roslyn cubes as musical notes, you know, ascribing a musical note to each pattern, then it becomes very obvious very quickly which notes are in the wrong place.
Right.
So you would simply correct them on your musical notation, and then you would sit at your piano and play the melody. And that's exactly what they did. And it's called the Roslyn Motet.
Wow.
And they had it played professionally, and it sounds absolutely beautiful. So then what happened was this filmmaker, this documentary filmmaker, obviously thought, wow, here we've got an interesting story, particularly because in the Da Vinci Code movie, Rosalind Chapel is, you know, one of the scenes in the movie. And as a matter of fact, the day that Annalise and I were there, this is, I don't know how many years ago this is, that when they were filming the Da Vinci Code, we had already booked to go to Rosalind Chapel to do some acoustics work in the crypt, which is, you know, the underground or subground area that has such a beautiful acoustic.
Wow.
And we'd booked with the, you know, the officials at Rosalind Chapel. And we arrived there this day, a whole party of us with equipment, kind of very basic Cymascope that we had at the time, went up to the office of Rosalind, and they said, oh gosh, yes, we'd forgotten that you were coming. We can't let you in to the crypt today because they're filming the Da Vinci Code movie.
Oh my gosh.
And they have a whole set. You know, the set in the crypt and the very place that you want to go.
Oh my goodness.
And I said, but you know, we've driven up from Newcastle. There are was it more than a dozen people who'd flown over from America, especially, you know, to go for this event.
Did you see Tom Hanks?
No, that none of the none of the cast were there, but who were there was two very, very large gentlemen.
Oh, right.
Who said, I can't let you into the crypt because you would see things. If I let you into the crypt, I'd have to kill you.
You might see part of the plot, let alone that you're solving ancient mysteries. We might see a peg in the plot of a Hollywood film.
I know. He did actually, I don't know whether, I think he was joking when he said, I'd have to kill you, but you know. Anyway, so then after quite a lot of negotiations, they did in the end allow us the crypt with the whole set.
Oh, that's pretty
nice. And we did some really interesting experiments in there that day with this very basic sand-based Cymascope.
Wow.
And one of the things, there was a lady there who sang with a very high-pitched voice, and she sang into the microphone, which then the results went into this very basic early Cymascope device. And what came up on the screen, you know, because we had a camera firing, you know, video camera firing at this membrane, and what came up on the screen was a whole field of crosses, and we've never seen anything like it before or since. And these crosses, it turns out, are the symbol of the family, of the Roslin family, the Sinclair family.
Hey,
this is the symbol of the... I mean, how does this work?
This is like you in your sarcophagus.
I know, it is, isn't it?
Making writing.
It's astonishing. I still don't know the answer to that,
but it did happen.
It did happen that day. Anyway, I'm kind of digressing, aren't I? Because you asked a question, you know, about the Da Vinci Code movie. The documentary. What happened was that the filmmaker called us up and said, look, we know that you know Stuart and Thomas Mitchell, and, you know, they've supposedly decoded the Roslin cubes, you know.
Wow.
We want to know if this is real. And would you be willing, we know that, you know, you're something of an expert in this area, and would you be willing to do an experiment live on camera in your laboratory to show that this is real or not real? And I was a bit nervous about this. Why? Because they're our friends. You know, we didn't want to
embarrass them
or cause any difficulty
right.
in that area. But anyway, in the end, we thought, well, integrity is integrity, and you just got, you know, what is real is real.
Right.
And if it turns out not to be real, then, you know, that would be unfortunate. And so we went ahead, and the filmmaker came here, and on camera, we actually put the notes that Stuart and Thomas had, you know, identified, and we put them into, not into the Cymascope, because obviously what we were interested in was seeing patterns on a resonant plate. So it's like a Chladni plate, but instead of where normally a Chladni plate is bowed literally with a, you know, is excited with a violin bow, in this case, we had the Chladni plate being driven by a voice coil motor, so it's an electromechanical Chladni plate, so you can put any sound in and see the resulting pattern. And we put all the notes in that Stuart and Thomas had identified, and one by one, we proved that their notes created the relevant patterns on the cubes. Thus, you know...
Right.
making a nice statement for the I think it was called the real Da Vinci Code. Was it the real Da Vinci Code? I think it was. Or the true Da Vinci Code, something like that. And it was a really interesting exercise. Yeah. And what it meant was, at the end of the day, it meant that those cubes in the Lady Chapel of Roslyn really do encode a melody, and that melody you can hear just by downloading the Roslyn motet. I think you can go online and download it from Stuart Mitchell's website.
See, my take on it, I'd be curious, because of what I've been learning with sound healing, and that a lot of power is held in the intervals of notes, and very powerful physiological effects can be demonstrated scientifically by certain intervals, such as the perfect fifth, which for non-musical people, if you go C, D, E, F, G, that's five. So C, G, play them together, that's the perfect fifth. Mm. And John Beaulieu, who has all of his research in the sound healing, he hooked people up and took their blood while they were being exposed to those intervals, and the body released nitric oxide, which was very healing and like a little police force going through the arteries and the blood and everything. So I wonder, with these Roslyn stones, that perhaps what if it's not a melody, and what if it is a sequence of intervals, for example, that when played together might put people in a certain state of consciousness that would be appropriate for a place of praying and worship. You know, what if it's not a melody? What if those are series of chords, you know, that wash people in those interval vibrations?
But
you
guys! But Natalie, it is a melody. It's been proven to be a melody.
But how do they know that those are supposed to be played as a melody, like bom, bom, bom? What if those notes were supposed to be played together?
Okay,
like chords?
I agree that there's a certain amount of, you know, musical interpretation has to come into the work that they did. They have, for example, there's nothing to suggest the length of the notes. They have to decide on the length of the notes, don't they? Because there's no way. I mean, the pattern denotes the note. Yes, we know that. We've proven that. But there's nothing that you can change a melody quite a lot if you change the length of the notes as well as the notes themselves. So there's certainly, it's absolutely not definitely this particular melody. It could be a slightly altered version of it, but still, for my money, it's a melody.
You reckon it's a melody, not chords of music played at the same time, sounds played together with a certain sequence of intervals.
I know for sure that sounds played together to create musical intervals do evoke bodily emotions. There's no question. I mean, that's why when we listen to certain music that we particularly resonates with us, it can emote us into tears or laughter or some other form of bodily emotion. And that's why the whole science of music therapy works. You know, if you look at the clinical aspects of music therapy, that's a science that's been developing since, again, the 1950s, I would say. And now it's used in hospitals all over the world. They use music therapy as a means of calming patients before surgery, after surgery. You know, for people that have psychiatric problems, music is used as a therapy and so on. It's a very powerful tool. However, you know, different pieces of music and different intervals will affect individuals in a different way. So there's no, although it is a science, it's a science in which choice comes into it, you know, individual choice as to which pieces of music most affect you, make you happy. Mm. And so a clinician will be asking you, you know, which piece of music would you like to hear? And they know that when a favorite piece of music is played to you, it will have a beneficial effect on your physiology. There's no question about that.
So where are you going with this Cymascope? What's the master now vision for you?
Well, the Cymascope is a remarkable instrument, and its potential is, well, it's almost unlimited, because as we talked about at the very beginning, sound was present right from the beginning of the Big Bang. It even organized the matter in the universe, or so the cosmologists believe. And it influences every aspect of our lives. And so if any any science requires, obviously, information. You have to have information in order to study a science. And the Cymascope provides that information, but in a completely new way. This is an analog or a model of what sound looks like. And, you know, we've made visible the sound of the stars. You know, when you have sound files, we talked about sound and how it sound in a star can be monitored simply by the light coming from the star. And then you demodulate the light from the star and you can hear the sound in the star. And then you can put that sound file into the Cymascope and you can see the sound in the star. Mm. And therefore you can, you know, from a astrophysicist's point of view, they can study what's happening in the star by simply listening to the, effectively listening to the light from the star. And the Cymascope is an instrument that can help with that. The Cymascope can help make speech visible in a completely new way. Instead of using a spectrum analyzer to look at speech, you can look at it now on a Cymascope. And we have some professors who are now using the instrument in just that way, some linguistics professors, to study different types of language and how they compare with each other. And the Cymascope can be used in the field of zoology, as we've talked about earlier, with the work with, oceanography, I should really say, in the field of cetaceans, listening, making visible the sound of dolphins, the sound of whales, and so on. You know, virtually every field of science you can think of. We talked about biology earlier, you know, making the sound of cells visible and so on and so forth. It's an astonishing new tool that can help science in many, many different ways. It's still being developed, of course. It's still not in its final version yet. It'll take many years to develop it further. But even as it stands now, it's a wonderful new tool to help science, and we feel very privileged to be working with it on a day-to-day basis.
Do you sell them on your website? Is it possible to buy a Cymascope?
You can buy a Cymascope. They're certainly not inexpensive items. In fact, I would say the opposite. They're actually very expensive. And also, when you buy a Cymascope to work with a Cymascope, you don't just buy the Cymascope. You need to buy a whole armory of ancillary equipment. You know, you need the camera, obviously a good video camera to work with. You need various items of sound processing gear. So it's quite an investment. Right. You know, you're not just buying a simple instrument that you can plug and play.
It's not a whim.
No.
That one
you
buys
have to be
a
very serious-minded and have quite deep pockets, actually. But we are now developing, in addition to the app that I mentioned earlier, we are developing a new Cymascope, which will be much more affordable than the current model. And
I want a beta version.
Oh,
just
do you?
Putting my name.
Okay,
in the hat.
Duly noted.
I want a discount, a nominal discount, because it might not work. It'll be a prototype, and I'm willing to take the chance.
Oh no, it will work, but we'll definitely do you a good deal, Natalie.
Excellent.
It's probably going to be called Cymascope Mini.
I love it.
Because it's a smaller version.
It sounds cute already. If it's a cute Cymascope, even better.
And the really beautiful thing about it is that it's fully integral. You don't need to buy a separate camera. You don't need sound equipment. Mm. Everything is built into it.
Excellent.
And so that's an exciting prospect, and it should be available hopefully later this year.
I'm going to go rescue the screaming yeast cell.
And the Cymascope app, just to finish with that as well, it's now available for Apple platform, for iPhone and iPad. And we've just completed the Android version of this beautiful app.
Great.
And that's coming, it'll be coming on stream next month sometime.
Brilliant. Well, I'll make sure links to everything are at the official website, thegreatescape.com. And I can't thank you enough for letting me kidnap you in your own home, hold you prisoner in your own lab.
We've had fun. It's been great chatting,
and it's been pretty mind blowing as well. And I'll put all the links to all your goodies. And just thank you so much, John Stuart Reid, and I wish you much success with all of these fascinating endeavors that you're a part of.
Thank you so much, Natalie.
Now you say a really big compliment back to me. Kidding. As always, you can find links to all the cool stuff you just heard about at thegreyescape.com, including a link to John's website, cymascope.com, where he can create a stunning mandala of your own voice. You'll find a link to the Cymascope app and and photos of the Roslyn Chapel blocks we spoke about, and a video of John demonstrating a Chladni plate. A Chladni plate, it doesn't get nerdier than a Chladni plate. Go and behold. And if you liked this episode, please go to iTunes and subscribe so you don't miss all the great upcoming guests, like Pierre Rubessa, who has been working away in secret in Switzerland and invented a gadget just like what you saw in the movie Elysium, where you lie down and it fixes you without cutting you open. It just makes a sound and it fixes you. Art becomes life. Science fiction becomes science fact. And you won't believe where Pierre Rubessa got his information. We are literally talking out of this world. Please rate and review this show on iTunes, and then my cells will stop screaming. Thank you guys for listening. I see you on my statistics map of planet Earth. You guys are all over the place. But don't you worry, I can see your exact dot. So thank you. Take care, and I'll catch you next time on The Grey Escape.